5 months ago, Jean Pascal and Bernard Hopkins battled for 12 rounds in a classic contest of youth versus experience. The young man knocked the older man down not once, but twice to take an early lead on the scorecards. But the older man showed he was far from finished with a late and powerful onslaught. Yet when the final bell rang,
after 12 rounds of boxing, the decision is a majority draw.
Both men left bitterly disappointed.
I really felt that night that I won the fight.
He has to understand and know that he didn't win that fight.
Tonight, Pascal and Hopkins return to the ring, and not a moment too soon, as both men have newfound hostility for each other.
May 21st, you better be on something, because I'm going to bust your ass.
Don't be surprised if I kill him.
A hard-punching 28-year-old Pascal.
Hard right hand by Pascal.
Will have thousands of his hometown fans behind him.
I'm training for one purpose, to win the fight.
For the 46-year-old Hopkins, a victory would make him the oldest boxer ever to win a world title.
I have the drive to make history.
This evening, live from Montreal, Canada, Pascal and Hopkins meet again. A second chance for one to emerge with a career-defining win. First, though, Chad Dawson returns to Montreal in search of redemption. Last time here, he suffered his first professional defeat at the hands of Pascal.
That is a bad butt. That is a super bad headbutt.
Now, with the help of new trainer Emmanuel Stewart, Dawson hopes to leave with a win over Canadian Adrian Diaconu. It's an exciting night in the light heavyweight division. First up, Dawson Diaconu, followed by our main event, Pascal Hopkins II.
Outside of the Bell Center in Montreal, home of the Montreal Canadiens, outside the majesty of the Guy Lafleur statue, inside the arena, the majesty of four legitimate contenders for the light heavyweight championship of the world on this same HBO doubleheader card. Hello again, I'm Jim Lampley. As you know, in the main event, 46-year-old Bernard Hopkins will attempt to supplant George Foreman, who was 45 when he knocked out Michael Moore for the heavyweight championship in 1994. To become the oldest man ever to win a major divisional championship in boxing. But to do that, he must beat Jean Pascal, something he came ever so close to doing in December, not far from here in Quebec City, something he firmly believes he is going to get done tonight. And prior to that, we'll see Chad Dawson, the man from whom Pascal lifted the light heavyweight championship here last August in his first return to the ring against another Montreal fighter, former Romanian amateur star Adrian Diaconu. And the new wrinkle for Dawson is a brand new trainer. Our normal ringside expert commentator, Emmanuel Stewart, who's made a habit throughout his career of rehabilitating fighters after the loss or the first disastrous loss. That's what he's trying to do with Dawson. Let's go to Max Kellerman outside Dawson's dressing room with Emmanuel right now.
Here with a broadcast colleague and one of the greatest trainers in this day or any other, Emmanuel, why did you decide to work with Chad Dawson?
I always thought that Chad Dawson had a lot of talent that he wasn't using. And instead of complaining, I decided when I had the opportunity to work with him, I said, I want to try to work with him and see if I can bring out some of the talent that I believed he had. And most of the people that boxing always felt he was one of our most talented fighters who never lived up to his potential. But I've been very, very satisfied with what I've saw. Unbelievable great hand and eye coordination. And also, he's just a little too relaxed. And what I've did with him is try to get him to be a little bit more intense, to utilize his height a little bit more, and to use his jab a lot more than he has in the past.
Do you think his hearing your commentary and criticism of his performance against Pascal on HBO when he lost that fight led to him wanting you to train him?
I don't know. He's never discussed it with me, but I think it's a good possibility because I thought that he had more talent than Pascal, but he was bending down, ducking, and not utilizing his height. And pretty soon, Pascal could figure out where his head was going to be. And so he would just almost land a punch sometime. The crowd would go crazy. And he didn't seem to get excited until the 11th round, realizing he was losing his title. And what he did in the 11th round, I think he could have did that earlier if he had started, and it would not have been a loss on his record.
My favorite quote from you leading up to this fight, you said you're concussion crazy and you want knockouts. Dawson is built like one of those old-time Kronk fighters that you used to train, Tommy Hearns or Milton McCrory. Are we to expect a knockout tonight, do you think?
I think you should expect a knockout tonight. He's been watching a lot of Tommy Hearns tapes.
Well, we look forward to it, Emmanuel. Great talking to you. Jim?
If you followed the sport, you know that Emmanuel Stewart is an offensive fighter's trainer. That's what Chad Dawson's people are looking for. Better offense tonight. Now let's quickly go to Michael Buffer in the ring to get the evening started after we look at the tail of the tape for Dawson against Diakonu. And you'll see the age advantage of 4 years for Dawson. Big height advantage. He's nearly 6'2" tall, and Diakonu is only 5'9". Arm length advantage of 2.5 inches measured from the armpit to the end of the fist. Dawson weighed in 18 ounces under the 175-pound limit. Diakonu 12 ounces under. Tonight, they will enter virtually equal at 187 and 186. And now, let's go to Michael Buffer to get the evening started.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, merci. Your attention, please, at this time. Just a few days ago, a favorite to the world of boxing passed away. Bill Gallo was a legendary journalist, and his editorial artwork was without equal. His body of work went from Joe Louis and Joe DiMaggio to Mickey Mantle and Muhammad Ali to Derek Jeter and Mike Tyson. He is without equal in his field. At this time, we would like to honor him and his memory with a memorial toll of 10 bells. Please remain silent, ladies and gentlemen. Rest in peace.
He was an amateur star for Romania, twice a medalist in the World Championships. He fought at the Olympics in Sydney in 2000, and then, with his countryman Lucien Boutte, left Sydney, came directly here to Montreal, and never again repatriated in Romania. There was a moment 2.5 years ago when he acquired a light heavyweight championship, and then he defended it against another Montreal fighter, Jean Pascal. And what happened in that fight, an all-action fight, is what first gave Pascal a light heavyweight championship belt, Max.
Pascal was coming up from super middleweight where he lost one fight to the very good Carl Frosch. People were watching this fight with a lot of anticipation. What would Pascal be at light heavy? And these two turned in a really sensational back-and-forth slugfest, won narrowly by Pascal.
Months later, they fought again here in Montreal, and is so frequently the case when one fighter wins a spirited battle by decision the first time around, the second fight slightly less active, same result.
Yeah, it was still dramatic and entertaining, but Pascal won by a much wider margin.
Et maintenant, mesdames et messieurs, se présente sur le ring, Adrien, the Shark, Diakonu.
Diakonu has been broadly ignored by media in the build-up to this evening. All three other fighters on the card, very distinctive stories coming into the night. He comes in somewhat under the radar, particularly for American boxing fans. Nicknamed the Shark, he is a straight-ahead fighter, a worker bee, and the thing for Dawson is not to allow Diakonu to get into a pattern of coming forward and penetrating his defense.
Sure, he's a smaller fighter. He has to get inside on Dawson if he wants to win, but Diakonu's not without talent. He does have some speed, some power, some natural ability, as you mentioned. It's a distinguished amateur career. Certainly not the talent, raw talent of Chad Dawson.
He got back into the winning column against veteran Omar Sheikha several months ago and feels as though he's very well prepared for Dawson tonight. Dawson was 29-0 prior to coming here as a favorite against Jean Pascal last August. And in that fight, Dawson, who seemed distracted prior to the fight, got off to a slow start. Pascal jumped him in the early rounds and built a lead that he did not surrender.
Not to take credit away from Pascal, whose style certainly bothered Dawson, but it also did indeed seem that that was not the best Chad Dawson we've seen. It was widely reported that personal distractions distracted him in the lead-up.
And while Dawson was coming on in the late rounds, a clash of heads caused the cut. Pascal was ahead on the scorecards. He became light heavyweight champion of the world.
And making his entrance to the ring by Chad Dawson.
Dawson fought his best fight back in 2007, Max, when he easily defeated Tomas Adamek head up in Kissimmee, Florida.
Though at the time, we didn't know how good a win that was because we knew Adamek was good, just not this good as he moved up to cruiserweight and then heavyweight and had so much success. Dawson won the whole fight except for the moments he was on the canvas late, but he got up, finished the fight, won a lopsided decision, and you're right, Jim, so far to date, his most impressive performance.
And given the fact that he followed that up with two victories over Antonio Tarver and two wins over Glenn Johnson, you have to say, oh, impressive career. But he wasn't nearly as impressive in any of those fights as he had been against Adamek.
We all thought at the time, well, this is Chad Dawson cleaning up the old guard, Tarver and Johnson. And as it turned out, he did, but then he couldn't get by the new guard. And that's Jean Pascal, who is now champion as a result of his win.
Physically, Dawson is extremely gifted. He has offensive skills. He may be exactly the right kind of project for Emmanuel Stewart.
Stewart taking on a fighter oftentimes is a signal. Hey, this is the most talented guy in the division. Vladimir Klitschko, for example. In terms of pure talent, Chad Dawson seems as though he's the most talented light heavy in the world.
Let's go to Michael Buffer now for the official introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, bienvenue au Centre Bell, Montréal, Québec, Canada. This bout is a presentation of Group Yvon Michel and Golden Boy Promotions in association with Gary Shaw Productions and Interbox, sponsored by Dynastie 2, with mise en jeu de Vidéotron and Coors Light. Sanctioned by Des Sports de Combat de la Régie des Écoles de Cause des Jours, Director Michel Hamlin. The three judges at ringside for this contest will be Claude Paquette, Benoit Roussel, and John Woodburn. And inside the ring, in charge of the action at the bell, Michael Griffin. And now 12 rounds of boxing. This is in the light heavyweight division. Oquan Blue in the blue corner, wearing black, official weight 174 pounds, 4 ounces. His professional record, 27 victories, 15 by knockout with only 2 defeats. Originally from Romania, now living, training, and fighting out of Montreal, Quebec, Canada, the WBC number 5 ranked contender in the world, former WBC interim light heavyweight world champion, Andrian the Shark Diakonu. Oquan Rouge in the red corner, wearing Crown Gold, officially weighing in at 173 pounds, 10 ounces. His professional record in 30 fights, 29 victories, including 17 knockouts, only 1 defeat. From New Haven, Connecticut, USA, the number 1 ranked WBC contender in the world, and former WBC IBO light heavyweight champion of the world, Bad Chad Dawson.
All right, both you men, receive my instructions in the dressing room. Obey my commands, protect yourselves always, men. I want you to touch gloves now, you're boxing at the bell. God bless both of you.
Everyone in the fight game knows Chad Dawson's real good. We're here tonight to find out if Emmanuel Stewart can make him truly bad Chad Dawson. Can he be bad? Can he punch with bad intentions, score a knockout maybe even?
Your corners, man. Bell, man. Box.
Let's see if Dawson gets off to a faster start than was the case August 14, 2010, in this ring against Pascal. A taller fighter working behind the stiff jab. That's an Emmanuel Stewart staple. In Dawson's case, yet another of the many stars in the sport for whom the lead hand is actually the stronger hand. He is naturally right-handed, went into the gym and began fighting as a southpaw, has stayed that way ever since. See Oscar De La Hoya, see Miguel Cotto, see any number of other stars in recent years, going back to Michael Moore, the first southpaw ever to win the heavyweight championship.
The difference in their height was startling during the stare down, although Diakonu, maybe it was exaggerated because Diakonu was looking down. But what Emmanuel Stewart, I think, brings to fighters offensively, Chad Dawson, tremendous talent, land three or four punches at the target. Emmanuel Stewart teaches fighters to punch through the target, like a follow-through for a pitcher in baseball. And that's how these long, lanky fighters he gets are able to score these devastating knockouts a la Tommy Hearns. There maybe we see an example of Dawson punching through a target, or trying to at least.
Another thing Emmanuel does with fighters is to spend a lot of time in training talking about the history of boxing, talking about veteran fighters of the past and what they've done. In Dawson's case, he's had him looking at a lot of films of Tommy Hearns, hoping that Dawson can learn to put more power on his left hand.
Don't punch it. Step back. Don't punch it. Step back.
Dawson says that's a matter of getting his shoulder into it, and that he has seen the way Hearns did it. But of course, Hearns' natural power was in his right hand.
That makes a big difference.
In Dawson's case, his power hand is not by nature his stronger hand.
Which may actually be the correct strategy. Maybe that's why more and more fighters are using their lead hand, their power hand, as their lead hand. The advantage being 75% or more of your punches are thrown with this front hand. Why not have that be your natural hand, your power hand? On the other hand, the straight power shot, you would think, would be less effective.
What we're seeing in the first round is Dawson throwing virtually all the punches here. Diakonu speeding up just a little bit in the latter part of the round.
Frank, no punches, step back.
Dawson is gonna wind up with CompuBox number edges here. And certainly he's gotten off to a more self-contained, more assertive start than was the case against Pascal.
Hartman.
Good job, I like it.
Yeah, how you feel? All is here. Deep breath.
Yeah.
Deep breath. Good job, Ari.
Yep. Trying to land you with the right legs. Check the same time you kick the left hand when you're parrying the shot. Check and you break right back with it. That'll break it up. Because all he's trying to do is get the right knee. But you're breaking it down mentally slow, okay?
Inside, when you go back, viva.
You just start a little too far, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Sharpen your legs, put some legs there. When you get a little closer, then you can start the attack. You just start a little too far, okay? That's a very good shot. You counter, we did a very good shot.
Get closer with the leg.
CompuBox numbers in round one. Dawson of 9 of 49. Jacquinoux 7 of 28. Jacquinoux throwing only 6 jabs in the entire round, as opposed to Dawson, who threw 29 of them. Once again, Dawson begins working his jab early in round two. Stands to reason, if Dawson's going to throw something close to 30 jabs per round, then Jacquinoux isn't going to try to go with him. Jacquinoux's going to have to land some power shots. Most particularly, he's probably going to have to try to get to Dawson's body.
You would think, although Jacquinoux told us in the fighter meetings, or his trainer at least hinted, that their strategy against Dawson is to feint, draw a counter from Dawson, and then counter the counter, which is not conventional thinking with a shorter fighter, as you mentioned, has to get inside and work the body, you would think.
Particularly a shorter and slower fighter. That sounds like something that works if you have a speed advantage.
Right.
Good 1-2 by Dawson. There's some intensity from Chad Dawson. He looks so laconic and relaxed in there that you can question in your own mind whether he's really working. But he has such athletic talent that he can smooth it.
No two ways about it. So far, if the question is, will Emmanuel Stewart make him punch more seriously, I think the answer is yes. You see the follow-through in the punches. You see Dawson. It's not that he's been so outstanding so far, but he's punching with bad intentions.
There's always an adjustment process. When Emmanuel Stewart first brought Mikel Cotto into the ring against Jerry Foreman last year at Yankee Stadium, you could almost feel Cotto working his way into fighting Emmanuel's way round by round. Dawson, another 1-2. One other element of the Emmanuel Stewart game plan, particularly with a fighter who's taller than his opponent, don't overcommit, don't lean forward, don't ever let your chin go past your front knee. And if you wonder what's the danger of letting your chin go past your front knee, think Paul Williams against Sergio Martinez last November. Overcommit, lean too far forward on the left, and boom, your chin is hanging out there. Lennox Lewis against Oliver McCall a long time ago. Manuel tries to clear that out of the game plan first. Straight left, and that speaks to your point, Max. He's punching harder.
Looks that way.
You're on. You're starting to touch it. You're slowly slowing down. Good round. You're on up and down, okay? All right. You got to think, first, maybe the most important punch for whatever reason. To play enough hook with your body. Every time you throw the left hand, you're coming back with the hook, and it wasn't good. As he slows down, you're going to start hitting him more and more, but you're starting to find him with the left hand slowly now. Okay. So I got you one up.
Sure. We talk about waiting a little bit. You need a little bit more activity right now, okay? Yes, the rhythm is perfect for him right now. That's what we want. Okay. You know, when he finished tiring.
Here's that left hand from Dawson that we commented on at the time. You can see Jacquinoux blocked it with his glove, but the point is, Dawson's throwing it with so much force, it knocked Jacquinoux's left hand into his own face and then knocked Jacquinoux backwards.
CompuBox numbers in round two, very similar to those in round one. More one-sided. Dawson 21 out of 52. Jacquinoux only 3 of 29.
There's an opportunity for Dawson here, Jim, in that before he lost to Pascal,
good body shot by Dawson,
he was generally considered the heir apparent in terms of the best American fighters to Floyd Mayweather. And then he loses to Pascal, and now that distinction goes to Andre Ward or Tim Bradley. both of whom engaged in lackluster outings in their last performances. Here's a chance for Dawson to reassert himself, to reinsert himself into that conversation. Best American fighter not named Floyd Mayweather.
So you're suggesting Ward was less than sensational in his win over Arthur Abraham?
Listen, he's an excellent all-around fighter, but I'm sure Andre would tell you it wasn't his best performance, at least not his most scintillating.
There's the most threatening punch thrown in the fight by Jacquinou so far, but it didn't land. Thought he had Dawson in position for a big right hand. Combination lands for Dawson there. I find myself impressed with what I've seen of Dawson in 2.5 rounds so far, Max. There's definite improvement, it appears, from the fighter who came in here last August. But of course, the fighter who came here last August had family problems, had been recently moved from Connecticut to Las Vegas, and didn't seem to be 100% here.
And was fighting a guy who'd beaten this guy, Diakonu, twice. Fighting a better fighter.
Now he has not only a new trainer, but a new manager as well. And he has regained the services of a nutritionist and physical trainer who was with him previously, but had been replaced for the last couple of fights by another one chosen by his previous manager.
Jim, Dawson's starting to go to that power hand left uppercut that Emmanuel mentioned to us yesterday was actually his best power punch, which is rare for a tall, lanky fighter who has leverage punching down with straight left hands. Instead, Dawson prefers the uppercut, which can be very effective against a short fighter who leans in.
And so far, the straight left hands are coming off the jab, but against a conventional fighter, particularly a shorter one, there may be a chance for Dawson to lead with the left here and shock him from time to time.
Good defense there by Dawson.
Jacquinou starting to take many more chances. He was very conservative in the first two rounds. He took some risks in the last minute of round three. Now let's take a look at Jean Pascal, who left Haiti at the age of 4 and moved here to Canada with his mother. Regards himself as thoroughly French-Canadian. First language is Creole, second language is French, third language is English. Previously a star at 168 pounds, and the fighter he wants to emulate, Max Kellerman, is the great Roy Jones, the Roy Jones at his peak of 15 years ago.
Yeah, ironic because Roy was so talented, he never had to be tough. Jean Pascal tries to fight like Roy without the same level of talent, so he has to be really tough, take punches to land his own. He's never been knocked down, though he has stamina issues. He always finishes the fight on his feet.
Chad Dawson, through the first three rounds, is throwing an average of more than 30 jabs per round. 21 out of 95 in the jab category. Jacquinou, 10 out of 43, stepping up considerably in round three after two very slow rounds to begin. Harold, how do you have it so far?
Okay, Jim, 3 rounds to nothing, 30 to 27. Bad Chad Dawson. Jim, I gotta tell you, Chad Dawson got a nice right jab. You know, Emmanuel Stewart's got him standing straight up. I mean, I said to myself, I'm watching a totem pole, you know? The guy is really straight up. Emmanuel figured out that he's a very, very tall, light heavyweight, and he wants him to fight tall, and he's doing that by standing straight up. And he takes that to his advantage. He's using that right jab beautifully. Outworked the Diakonu in the first and the second round. In the third round, he went to that up jab, and he's killing him with the up jab. I mean, he's got a nice snap to that up jab. 3 to nothing, Chad Dawson.
As usual, excellent observations from Harold. Another thing that came out in the fighter meetings yesterday is Emmanuel wanted Dawson to stop fighting like Pernell Whitaker. He's 6'2", not 5'6". Why get low to avoid punches? Get tall.
And when you think, okay, what tall fighter are we talking about? Think Lennox Lewis and Vladimir Klitschko. That's the formula.
And Tommy Hearns, who is also 6'2".
Stay tall, use your height, never give it away, set up the power punches with the jab. That's what Dawson's doing well tonight. Good body shot by Dawson. Jacquinou gets back at him with a right hand.
And there's the disadvantage of what we were just talking about. Standing up straight, got caught with two crooked punches.
Because of the significant height disadvantage, even when Jacquinoux lands, he's punching up. And that means less leverage, and over the course of the fight, probably less power than he'd like to get. There's the uppercut that Max mentioned before. Crowd oohs and ahs as Jacquinoux got in another right hand.
And it was clean like the two earlier in the round.
In the middle of a Dawson combination. Jacquinoux starting to lead with the right hand occasionally. Working his jab much more than before. Best round of the fight by far for Adrien Jacquinoux.
You can see his punches. You know, you can fight him outside, but don't fight him halfway. Just if you want to, just walk him down. And just beat him inside if you want. You know that, either get back and lower, but don't be at a halfway distance. So just get him in one way or another, okay? You want to just walk him down with short shots. You can do that. You can see his punches.
There are always trade-offs, Jim. You get a little more offensive. You're going to be open a little more. 1-2 land cleanly for Diakonu on Dawson. And here again, Dawson looking to do damage rather than to get away, and the trade-off is you throw harder. When you connect harder, but you can be hit cleanly.
CompuBox numbers through round four. Dawson 71 out of 192. Jacquinoux 27 out of 156. Even in his most active round, in which he opened up and threw 54 punches, Jacquinoux only landed 7. Dawson was landing 21. Beating Jacquinoux to the punch with his much longer, better jab.
This is a stalking Chad Dawson, Jim. I mean, he's stalking Diakonu, looking to land. Not the cutie we've been used to seeing quite.
Good left hand by Dawson. Gets caught with a left hook in return. And a right hand by Jacquinoux. Now Jacquinoux's opening up and fighting with confidence and making contact with Dawson. Chad collects himself and goes back to the jab. Good defense there by Dawson, getting his hands up, blocking Jacquinoux's right hand shot.
And thus far, not shying away from the fight when Diakonu brings it to him.
Left hook by Jacquinoux. Interesting combination, right hand lead followed by the left hook.
The overhand right could be good for Diakonoux if he could get his left foot outside Dawson's lead foot against a taller fighter like Dawson. But difficult to position himself to throw that punch when Dawson has those good quick feet.
Sometimes in the past, working with different trainers, Dawson has been lazy about getting his front foot outside of the feet of conventional opponents, and that sometimes prevents him from maximum offense. Mentioned that Emmanuel Stewart is the 8th different trainer with whom Dawson has worked. Eddie Mustafa Muhammad had him for several fights, including the fight last August against Pascal. Floyd Mayweather Sr. was training him at the time when he beat Tomas Adamac in 2007. A trainer named John Scully did some good work with him early in his career. Last guy I remember having as many as 8 trainers was Johnny Tapia. That was for different reasons. Round 5 coming to a close. Coming up later in the main event, 46-year-old Bernard Hopkins tries to supplant George Foreman to become the oldest man ever to win a major division championship, a legitimate championship in boxing. Good right hook by Dawson to punctuate round 5. Earlier, our Max Kellerman went to Hopkins' dressing room to talk to them.
Bernard, before we even begin, what's up with the mask?
The execution of playing my part.
The first fight, most think you won. You didn't get the decision. How do you get out of here with a win tonight?
Be me. Be Bernard and go through there and do what I have to do. I come here on a mission. I come here to get in and get out. And so that's what I'm coming here to do. Take care of business and start from 13th round.
You're already one of the greatest old American athletes in history, right there with Archie Moore and George Foreman among boxers. But we've seen things recently that we're not used to seeing from you. You're knocked down against Pascal twice. You didn't make weight yesterday when you first got on the scales. What happened?
I didn't use the bathroom before I had the HBO meeting. 4 ounces. I mean, you can spit 4 ounces.
But it's never happened to you before.
Things have. I don't know. I know a lot of people would rather weigh 4 ounces than 14 pounds heavier.
Is there any way that you see this fight going differently than the first fight?
I don't think I know. I'm going to be me. Whatever comes after that is just bring the best out of me. So I don't really can't anticipate what the other guy's going to do. I just hope it'll be a good fight. And that you need 2 people to dance. You need 2 people to have a good fight. It can be a boring fight if one guy want to fight, one guy want to run. So I'm going to do my part. And I'm here to be the executioner.
Stop,
and that's
stop,
what I got to do.
Thanks, champ.
Now we return to the action in the ring. Round 6 of Schedule 12. Copy box numbers through the first 5 rounds show that in the power punching category, Dawson's landing 60%, 52 out of 87. If you were to go back to every fight that CompuBox has ever charted in their nearly 30-year history now, very rarely would you ever find anybody who landed 60% of his power punches and lost. It's a formula for winning.
So far, Dawson has made some changes that we've noted, Jim, in terms of his offense, punching harder. But I wouldn't say he's setting the world on fire right now. Ultimately, if he scores a concussive knockout, I think people will forget the fact that some of these middle rounds are turning into something less than scintillating.
How much is it that there's just something about his body language which belies a lack of intensity, which makes it seem as though he's simply more relaxed and more casual in there than you expect a great prize fighter to be?
I think it plays into it, absolutely.
And that may not necessarily be a flaw if it's just the way he is and if it's the way he performs best, but it doesn't look the way fans expect a championship fighter to look.
And the body language plays into fans' perception of great athletes, be it a quarterback or a second baseman. I think of the Yankees, Robinson Cano. Sometimes that talent allows a fighter or an athlete to look a little more laid back than people would like. And then they're less able or willing to forgive mistakes.
Fans appreciate intensity, both in athletes and in coaches. They think it means that the guy is trying hard.
Right.
Certainly you'll see different personalities in the ring in the main event, where both Bernard Hopkins and Sean Pascal tend to project intensity all the time, though they don't necessarily fight at the same rate at which Dawson is throwing punches.
Isn't that interesting?
Maybe what I'm saying is he makes it look too easy.
You've got to
You feel? You good? This is your leg. You got your legs?
I said something. He's out.
You feel your legs? You feel your legs?
Listen. You chase that.
If you want to fight that close fight, don't just lay in there and slip in a slam. You get into a defensive mode. And he's winning the fight. Nobody's landing that much, but he's outworking you. You won't let your punches go. Okay, he's sloppy and tired, but it doesn't mean a damn thing. He's punching and you're not punching. And you're losing the fight.
Well, given that, I believe Harold Lederman has probably given five of the first six rounds to Chad Dawson. I wonder if Dawson believes what Emmanuel Stewart just told him. Stewart made clear before this fight that he was going to tell Dawson what he thought the score was after every single round. He didn't say he was going to fib about it to try to get him to perform harder.
Emmanuel Stewart doesn't want to hear Dawson's excuses in the corner. He wants a fan-friendly, exciting knockout artist. And he believes Chad Dawson can be that. And it seems that Dawson's redoubled his efforts here after the tongue lashing in the corner.
Harold, let's bring you in. Emmanuel Stewart told Dawson he's losing the fight. What do you think?
No way. 59, 55, five rounds to one, bad Chad Dawson. And I tell you, bad Chad Dawson's outworking this guy. No doubt about it. Jim, it's funny. You got to do what you got to do to psych your fighter. If Emmanuel wants to lie to him, if that's the way he's going to get him to punch more, well, that's what he's got to do. But be as it may, Chad Dawson using that right jab to pile up points, that good defense. You know, it's funny. Both guys are slipping an awful lot. I mean, it's very interesting. Emmanuel pointed it out to Dawson. You know, in between rounds five and six, it's the honest to God's truth. They are slipping a lot, and Dawson's not getting good leverage, you know. So maybe that's what's hurting him as far as his power punching is going. But be as it may, he's doing all the work. Five rounds to one, Chad Dawson.
Interesting how much they're slipping. The canvas is dry, but there's paint all over it. And sometimes the advertising paint can be slicker than the normal surface of the canvas.
Watch the back,
I think that's why in modern boxing you see fewer great exchanges right in the middle of the ring, maybe, than you would otherwise. Guys slip on the sides. Dawson watching him throw the right hook, Jim. Though it's a stronger hand, he seems to still need to get that right elbow up a little higher because it winds up slapping when it lands because the right elbow seems a bit low to me at times.
Good right hand by Jacquinoux. Again, Jacquinoux splits Dawson's guard, and that brings the crowd alive.
A
couple of body shots in there by Jacquinoux. The shark trying to make his presence felt. This time it's Dawson who waited for Jacquinoux to attack to try to counter him and landed a right uppercut. But now Jacquinoux is stepping up his work rate and beginning to get Dawson to back up.
Look, Jacquinoux's no cupcake. The only losses he's ever had in his career is to the same guy who handed Chad Dawson his only loss, Jean Pascal. Otherwise, he's beaten everyone he's faced.
And as we pointed out, a stellar amateur background, which is a hidden factor in true professional excellence. Max, let's take a look at the light heavyweight division. Prominent fighters.
Well, there's the champ, Jean Pascal. Tavares Cloud's got a belt. Exciting, aggressive American fighter. Had a great fight with Glenn Johnson on our air last year. Brommer was a talented amateur, getting a little long in the tooth. Legal problems have kept him inactive. Chumanoff, just a fun, fan-friendly TV-type fighter. Those are the belt holders. There's Bernard Hopkins trying to make history tonight. Bad Chad Dawson, still considered the most talented guy in the division and the lineal champion, the guy with a claim to beating the man who beat the man who beat the man, going back to Darius Mikulchevsky, is Zolt Erdai, the little-known Zolt Erdai, little-known in this country anyway.
CompuBox numbers in the seventh round, 22 out of 50 for Dawson, 13 out of 54 for Jacquinoux. That's the high number of connected punches in a single round for both fighters in the fight. And by the way, 50 punches for Dawson, who's averaging 50 punches per round, 54 for Jacquinou. The light heavyweight average output is 53.2. So they're fighting right at the pace that we would expect from light heavyweights in a fight like this. There's redness outside of both Jacquinou's eyes, but he's not swelling yet. There's no threat to his vision.
Punches up there.
Always done, falling back to that, which was highly effective. Opening up Diakonu's guard and creating some offense with his hand speed, but not punching really hard.
Dawson, originally from Hartsville, South Carolina, moved as a child to Hartford, Connecticut.
You know, he does something dangerous, Jimmy. He did it. He's done it several times, most noticeably 10 or 15 seconds ago. At times, Dawson drops both hands and pulls straight back from punches, leaving his chin exposed. Diakonu jumps in with a hook there. He could knock Dawson down.
Crowd seems to want Jacquinou to make it more of a rumble. Not that easily done when you are giving up 5 inches in height. And you're not as quick as the opponent. There's some hard punching by Dawson. Once again landing the uppercut.
Dawson needs to make something happen here. Last three or four rounds, the fight's got a bit monotonous. Not a bad fight, but lacking some of the drama that it looked like we may have in the early rounds.
Well, in the early rounds, we saw the changes he's attempting and the transformation that Emmanuel Stewart is looking for. For the last few rounds, he's looked like the same Chad Dawson who seemed to drift through several fights after his Adamic fight.
I'm not sure, okay?
If you missed it, catch a replay of Real Sports. Check out the story of how the Red Sox and Yankees are teaming up to raise money for the daughter of Red Sox coach who lost her leg in an accident. June 11, tune into the next HBO Sports documentary, McEnroe Borg, Fire and Ice, a compelling look back at the historic rivalry between two of the biggest stars in tennis history.
Touch it. And you can relax. It takes the pressure off of yourself. And just keep touching and probing with his hand until you catch something, and then go back to touching him again, okay? Keep him backing up. He's not going to catch you with anything when you're punching, because he's not that kind. He's going to get you when he runs in punching. Okay, let's go. Let's get it.
Dawson turning down the water from Emmanuel Stewart as he leaves the corner. He was 22 out of 57 by CompuBox count in the eighth round, stepping up the activity just slightly. 12 out of 35 jabs.
Hey, let him go, no punches, no punches, step back.
Round 9 of a scheduled 12, Chad Dawson seemingly cruising to victory over Adrian Diakonu. Diacono here in Montreal with the home crowd behind him, but able only sporadically to cause trouble for Dawson. And a couple of rounds ago, you heard Emmanuel Stewart trying to convince his fighter that he was trailing in the fight. We've sent Max Kellerman to the corner to talk to Emmanuel. Here he goes.
Let him go, Chad. Let it go right away. Left hand.
Emmanuel, what do you see? Why did you tell Chad you thought he wasn't winning the fight?
Because, you know, I'm still considering where we are. And you have to be safe. You can't go out and tell a guy you're winning the fight. And it's a question mark. I don't know. And this is still in Montreal, which has a reputation of not letting their fighters lose, so to say, even if you knock them out sometimes, as we saw in Andrade. So I think he needs to step it up. He's got nice defensive moves, but he's not punching enough as far as I'm concerned.
He seemed to be punching harder early, and then we hear you in the last round tell him, just touch him, touch him, touch him. Why?
No, it's just to set him up by keeping him busy watching the right, putting the right hand out there, where he'll be so busy watching the right hand. He won't get a chance to get set.
And while they're speaking, Diacono catches Dawson with a right and a left and momentarily shakes Chad Dawson. And now we've got a fight. And Emmanuel Stewart pointing out where we are. But at the moment that he was talking about that, it was Diacono who most responded to the possibilities and landed those shots on Dawson.
And Dawson took him well, Jim, and he's still firing back. A moment like that maybe is not the worst thing in the world for Chad Dawson's career, provided he survives it.
Earlier than that in the round, while you were conducting the interview, Max, we saw a couple of textbook examples of Dawson trying to throw the left hand the way Tommy Hearns threw the right hand, trying to turn it over the top and get his shoulder into it for maximum power. Something he's been studying on film with Emmanuel Stewart. Good uppercut, good right hook by Dawson. Momentarily stops Diacono's rally and has drawn blood from Diacono's nose. That was a good comeback in the latter part of the round by Dawson.
Okay, listen, I don't have to tell you what the situation is. This fight is up in there. What round is this coming up? We got 10. We got to sweep these rounds. This boy's tired. But you're not punching enough. You're not punching enough. You're making all these moves, and after you had him hurt, you're going to pull this round out, but you back off again. You got to fight and realize that this is it, man. You cannot mess around and go for no close decision. And I guess is what I'm saying. The guy is
going to make one, the full one.
Dawson's troubles started from him looking to be offensive, got clubbed behind the head. It's accumulation of three things. That's one, that's two. The jabs landed very solidly. And here's three. The right hand. No punch was devastating, but the combined effect of behind the head, a bit of the snapping of the neck with the straight punch, and then that third punch seemed to shake Dawson up a bit.
And right in the middle of it, there was an excellent Andre Dawson left hand, or Chad Dawson left hand counterpunch inside, which helped to even the rally up just a little bit. Harold, how do you have it through nine?
Okay, Jim. I thought Adrian Diacono pulled out the ninth round. He landed some real nice right hands. Six rounds to three, 87-84. Bad Chad Dawson. Jim, I don't know. I think that Chad Dawson should win this decision. He's boxing nicely, but, you know, Adrian Diacono has his moments. He gets in, lands nice right hands, good solid shots. I mean, if anybody's doing any serious damage, it's Diacono. But Chad Dawson working that right hand, the busier guy. Diacono certainly not busy enough. Based on his on clean punching, six rounds to three, Dawson.
Break! No punches, man. Step back, Chad. Don't
upon second review of that flurry by Diacono, that rally, it didn't look as impressive as I originally thought it would.
I agree. There's a straight right hand by Diacono that landed.
And Dawson's showing something here, Jim, that he's not backing away from the fight, that even in that last round, it was he who closed the frame strong.
Yeah, what I failed to see the first time around, but then saw in the replay much better, was that perfect counter left shot inside by Dawson that made his point in the middle of Diacono's rally.
Yeah, the guy landing the vast majority of the hard, clean shots is Dawson.
Well, for instance, in that round, even while Harold Lederman was scoring the round for Diacono, and I won't argue with that, but the CompuBox numbers showed Dawson landing 80% of his power shots, 20 out of 25.
I think the case can be made for Dawson in all three of the rounds that Harold gave Diakono.
Well, particularly if we were in Hartford.
Right.
Another good right hook. Diakono keeping his guard up to stop the left. Dawson able to come right around it with the hook. Diakono with his hands below his waist, trying to get Dawson to throw so that he can try to counter something. Good left up and under, right on the chin by Dawson. By the way, why did I suddenly throw Andre Dawson into the mix there? He's the most famous graduate of my high school, Southwest Miami High.
I thought you were conflating Andre Ward with Chad Dawson, Jim.
At the bell, man.
Still to come tonight, our main event, which Bernard Hopkins attempts to become the oldest man ever to win a legitimate championship at 46, surpassing George Foreman, who was 45 when he knocked out Michael Moore in 1994. Here's the obstacle. Jean Pascal, light heavyweight champion of the world, off his victory over Chad Dawson, August 14 of last year here in Montreal. An athletic fighter, a fighter who fights in spurts, explosions here and there, but a fighter who also has lapses defensively and can be hit, as Bernard Hopkins showed in the latter rounds of their fight in December.
He's not even there. You hear me?
With the right hook.
All right.
You open up with this man, he can't hold y'all because he's too damn tired.
Pop it right into the chest.
Bring your corner for the bell, Chad.
We've had a conventional fighter against a southpaw. A lot of lunging by Diakono in the fight, but we've not had a significant headbutt. That's lucky, frankly. Power totals through the 10th round for CompuBox. Dawson, 121 of 205, is landing nearly 60% of his power shots in the fight. Diakono, 61 out of 294. Overall punch count advantage for Dawson, landing 198 to only 87 for Diakono. So it's been an evening of tiny fits and spurts here and there for Diakono, and a pretty steady, although sometimes not terribly intense, onslaught by Chad Dawson.
And it speaks to Dawson's level of talent and craft that he has a new trainer. Sometimes you have to take a step forward, backward to take two steps forward. And maybe Dawson's in the process of taking that first step forward again, you know, after reworking his style. And yet, he's really dominating. One of the best light heavyweights in the world. Diakono's not one of the two or three, but certainly he's one of the 10 best. And Dawson's having his way with him throughout most of this fight.
Stop, stop, stop.
That's not a knockdown. That is a push. No significant punch was landed.
Break, break, stop, let him go.
You wonder what else Diakono could possibly try to change the flow of things here. He's jumped in. He's lunged with both lead left and lead rights.
I think he has to get in and stay in. Emmanuel Stewart fighters, the long, lanky ones, from Tommy Hearns to Vladimir Klitschko. The book on them has always been very tough to get in with those hard power shots and the long reach and the height. But once inside, if you can stay in their chest, you can rough them up. The advantage that Diakono has here is Chad Dawson doesn't hit like Tommy Hearns or Vladimir Klitschko.
But he hits hard enough that Diakono has not been willing at any time tonight to really pin his head onto Dawson's chest and try to work it.
And maybe Dawson's inside game is a bit better than Hearns and Klitschko.
He's quick with his hands inside, that's for sure.
And he is comfortable getting low and fighting like a small fighter.
And he does use the uppercut very freely, which some fighters won't do.
Exactly.
Push him, don't push him. Don't push him.
We are live at the Bell Center in Montreal, where American Chad Dawson is in the 11th round of his fight against Adrian Jacanu of Montreal, originally from Romania. Dawson trying to bounce back from the first loss of his career last August here in Montreal to Jean Pascal. And you'll be seeing Pascal later in the main event against Renard Hopkins.
You don't let him go. I told you to bend it down low and all that. You don't need to be low. Take a half a step back and let your punches go.
What round is coming up?
All right.
Keep your composure. Hands in front of you and go for it.
Yes.
He's gonna move around you. You know that. All right. Uh-huh. You know that he will move around you. Okay. Uh-huh. He will try maybe a little bit.
Yeah.
But you know he's playing safe right now. He will have to play safe a little bit. All right. Uh-huh. We need a dramatic knockout right now.
Yeah.
We need
it.
Fast. Okay. Uh-huh. Come on.
Tight. You move that head. You're surprising.
In Jacanu's corner, Pierre Bouchard and Stéphane Larouche together asking him for a dramatic knockout. They know the score. CompuBox numbers entering this, the final round. Dawson 209 out of 566. Jacanu 95 out of 513. Harold Lederman has Dawson comfortably ahead. And by the way, stick with us between fights for a very thoughtful and eloquent essay on Renard Hopkins' career by Larry Murchison. One Philadelphia star talking about another.
The idea for Dawson was to get a win. It looks like he's on his way to doing that. If the idea was to score a knockout or at least create some electricity, some excitement around Dawson, he's failed. Though I wouldn't say he hasn't taken a step forward in terms of being an offensive fighter, even if he's not maybe getting the results they want.
But by winning the fight, he has set himself up for the opportunity to fight the winner of the main event. Both Pascal and Hopkins acknowledge that if they win tonight, the next opponent is Chad Dawson if he gets past Jacanu. And Hopkins versus Chad Dawson is a fight that Dawson has wanted for quite some time without being able to get it. Jacanu got in a shot. Crowd comes alive just a little bit again. Hard right hand. He was told he needed a spectacular knockout. Now he's trying
Always
for it.
Always seems like in Montreal, fighters make these dramatic last-minute comebacks and fights they're losing to score knockouts.
He walked into a left uppercut from Dawson, which was a pretty solid shot, and so was the right hook there. Now Jacanu goes to work again.
Jacanu is watching Dawson's legs, thinking he's wobbled. I'm not sure if he's wobbled or the canvas is slippery.
I think it's the canvas. And incidentally, if you've never been inside a boxing ring, it's not like walking on a carpeted floor or a hard floor. It takes an adjustment to get used to it.
Late round drama.
Good clean shots inside by Dawson to blunt Jacanu's rally.
Every time Jacanu's made a rally and seemingly hurt Dawson in the fight, there's been two or three moments. Dawson comes back punching hard.
Good uppercut by Dawson. It's been his most effective shot for most of the night.
In spite of Dawson's body language and demeanor and lack of a knockout punch, he does have the temperament of a fighter, I think.
When threatened here in the 12th round, he has risen to the full. Fought with passion, controlled the action down the stretch, and has, in all likelihood, won the fight and the right to fight the winner of the main event.
Good job.
And here's the punch that Diakonu was trying to put Dawson to sleep with, but may have woken Dawson up instead. After this moment and a few following, Dawson started digging in and throwing big punches in return.
Might have been the single best shot of the night for Diakonu. Too little, too late. Unless something wildly unusual is going to take place on the scorecards here.
And incidentally, I thought Dawson won the 12th.
Harold Letterman may have given Diakonu the 12th on the basis of that good, clean right-hand shot. Often I've found that Harold will score a close round for the man who landed the single best clean hard punch. And here are the official judges for the fight, all three of whom are Canadian, and that's clearly part of what Emmanuel Stewart had in mind when he was so urgent in the middle of the doubt, trying to tell Dawson that he was behind, but that didn't appear to be the case. Claude Paquette, Benoit Roussel, only 8 title fights. Paquette, as you saw, had a little bit more experience than that. And Jack Woodburn, 17 title fights. He was the one who had Pascal so far ahead of Dawson on August 14. And that scorecard, frankly, wasn't all that logical. Both other judges had it 106-103. Gary Shaw, who's Dawson's promoter, said that he had it 106-103, Pascal. Good job. You gotta love Gary, who has a greater capacity than most promoters to be dead honest about his fighters.
When it doesn't hurt him too bad.
When it doesn't hurt him too badly, that's right. The laconic expression on the face of Chad Dawson, pretty much the same after the fight as before.
And during?
Unruffled, to say the least.
And if you're scoring knockouts with an unruffled look, you're Joe Louis. And if you're not, you don't care enough.
Let's take a look at our punch zone graphic to show you where the punches landed. Dawson absorbing only 107 punches in the fight, evenly distributed. Diakonu didn't really start going to his body until at least the middle rounds. Dawson was fairly sparing in his attack on Diakonu's body, only 29 body shots landed all night, though he got a little bit more aggressive about that later in the fight. That right hook landing 74 times on the left side of Diakonu's head. Well, actually, some of those were jabs, but the bottom line is most of the punches landed for Dawson upstairs. And now Michael Buffer stands above us with the official scores. Let's go to him.
Ladies and gentlemen, we go to the scorecards. Claude Paquette, 117, 111. Benoit Roussel, 118, 110. John Woodburn, 116 to 112. The winner by unanimous decision from Connecticut, USA, Bad Chad Dawson.
No giant surprises there. Unanimous decision win for Dawson. CompuBox numbers show his dominance throughout the course of the fight, pretty much doubling Diakonu, or even better than that in most categories other than thrown punches. Diakonu started very slowly, didn't really get cranked up until the middle rounds. Power shots, Diakonu ultimately wound up throwing more of them as Dawson was controlled in his output down the stretch. But when you land 59% of your power punches, as Chad Dawson did, barring some spectacular, unusual event, you are going to win the fight. We're at the Bell Center in beautiful Montreal, Canada, home to the Canadiens and to tonight's fight. Up next, our main event, Quebec native Jean Pascal taking on Bernard Hopkins. Let's call him Quebec resident Jean Pascal, taking on Bernard Hopkins in a rematch of their disputed draw from December. But before the bell rings, let's take a look at what HBO Boxing has in store for you in the weeks ahead.
June 4th, HBO's summer boxing schedule heats up when the undefeated Julio Cesar Chavez Jr. faces off against middleweight belt holder Sebastian Spick. On June 18th, one of the sport's hottest stars returns to the ring.
Alvarez doubles up that left again and a right.
20-year-old Canelo Alvarez looks to continue his meteoric rise as he defends his 154-pound title against Ryan Rhodes. Also that night, undefeated Adrian Broner takes on Jason Litzau in a 130-pound matchup. June 25, Devin Alexander is back on Boxing After Dark. Coming off his first professional loss to Timothy Bradley, the St. Louis native comes home against Argentine knockout artist Lucas Matisse. On July 2, the heavyweight fight all boxing fans have been waiting for. The on-again, off-again, and now on-again confrontation between Vladimir Klitschko.
A knockout win for Klitschko. That's what heavyweights are supposed to do.
And the hard-punching, trash-talking David Haye.
I'm going to eat you worse than this t-shirt.
I'm going to eat my fist. I promise.
An exciting few months in the ring on HBO's World Championship Boxing and Boxing After Dark.
We welcome you back live to the Bell Center in Montreal. Let's now get ready for the main event between John Pascal and Bernard Hopkins. Now, believe it or not, it's been 9 full years since Mike Tyson was eliminated as a competitive force in the heavyweight division once and for all by Lennox Lewis on June 8, 2002. Why is that significant? Because Bernard Hopkins is older than Mike Tyson. And at age 46, 9 years after Mike was gone, Hopkins remains a dynamic force in boxing. Tonight he tries to become the oldest man ever to win a legitimate championship in the sport, supplanting George Foreman, who was 45 years old when he knocked out Michael Moore in 1994. Hopkins is 192 days older than that. He's been a marvel for a long time. And what better way to size up this Philadelphia native than in the words of the one-time Boy Wonder sports editor of the Philadelphia Daily News, Larry Merchant. The crowd warms to the old warrior, Bernard Hopkins.
Big right hand by Hopkins,
the executioner at work.
Bernard Hopkins is out of one of those television ads that celebrate getting older and younger at the same time. Or like the fantasy of being born old and aging in reverse. What makes him keep running and fighting? In the early 90s, Hopkins was a lightly regarded Philadelphian, relegated to the shadows of the luminous Roy Jones. He emerged as a menacing executioner, won a marginal middleweight title, beat a list of marginal challengers, until his persistence paid off with a life-changing opportunity at 35. He was an underdog to another more popular, more exciting star, Felix Trinidad.
I might not be what y'all want me to be, but I am what I want to be, a man.
Scheduled for September 15th, 2001 at Madison Square Garden, it happened 2 weeks later because of 9/11. The chaos of that national trauma became a backdrop for Hopkins' assaulting, angry persona. The rage for recognition that fueled and fired Hopkins was balanced by controlled aggression in the ring, a style that enabled him to construct a masterpiece against the hard-punching Trinidad.
I think when it's all done, Bernard Hopkins will be known as one of the greatest middleweights that came along at all times. In my heart, I knew that I would get another chance in life to redeem myself from what I used to be into what I am now. Larry, I am the American dream. I am the American story.
To Hopkins, the victory validated his rehabilitation as an ex-convict who had been scared straight to the top of his profession. He made his first multi-million dollar score by collapsing the smaller Oscar De La Hoya. But fast, bigger opponents, Jermaine Taylor twice and Joe Calzaghe, seemed to expose his inevitable decline. But when he fought the liberate fighters, Hopkins in his 40s was and still is formidable. Another senior citizen, Antonio Tarver, was heavily favored to retire him, just where Hopkins wanted him.
The crowd exults in its adoration for Bernard, the executioner, Hopkins.
Kelly Pavlik also fell for the washed-up, over-the-hill underdog script that Hopkins thrives on.
Hopkins is staring down the media. He is making his point to the boxing writers, and he is establishing his eminence once again.
But it's the naysayers, Larry, and I need them. If I don't have them, Larry, I won't fight to my best ability. I don't know, it sounds crazy, but I need to have people against me.
Like the warden who released him from prison with the promise to welcome him back someday. Hopkins credits his longevity to genetics, athleticism and smarts, and monkish discipline. Add feral hardness, add a cautious style that has resulted in being beaten but never being beaten up. Add the incentive of still big money, and Bernard Hopkins keeps prowling like a shark as though stopping would be the end of him.
Well, there's one generation's take on Bernard Hopkins. Why don't you give us another, Max?
The greatest generation, as it turns out. Tonight is about Hopkins making history, or trying to, becoming the oldest man to ever win a championship, breaking George Foreman's record. But Hopkins has already made history. Hopkins is already one of the greatest old athletes in the history of sports. And besides, even if he wins the title tonight, there'll be more history to make. The oldest man to defend his title, right now a record held by Archie Moore. There'll be more history out there for Hopkins. What's most interesting to me about Bernard Hopkins right now is that for a guy who seemed to be doing it with smoke and mirrors in recent years, doing just enough to get by and not always win, against Pascal, he was a real fighter. Got dropped twice, got off the deck, badly hurt the second time, and went on to win the last eight rounds of the fight, not with smoke and mirrors, but with skills, heart, with his fists. Hopkins is gonna need those fists and need that fighter's mentality tonight if he hopes to win the light heavyweight championship of the world, Jim.
Something he came very close to doing, within a whisker of doing, really, in December here against Pascal. When they fought for the first time, December 18, Jean Pascal put Bernard Hopkins on the canvas twice in the early round. Here in the first round, with a punch that Hopkins contended was behind his head, it was actually slightly to the back of the ear, and then in the third round, with a legitimate shot that put Hopkins down. It was the first time he had been on the canvas twice in a fight in 18 years, and he responded.
Sure did. And Pascal, there were times where it looked like Pascal might not make it to the end of the fight, like maybe right there. But Pascal is a tough, young, determined fighter.
Most ringside observers felt that Hopkins had reeled the younger man in and ultimately won the fight. But two judges found two rounds in the last seven to give to Pascal, and as the result, the champion escaped with a draw and held on to the championship. Emmanuel Stewart, he's an athletic fighter. He fights in bursts and explosions. What must he do to control Hopkins and keep his championship tonight?
He's going to, first of all, have to be prepared to fight the full 12 rounds, because Hopkins is going to come out after him in this fight early. He's going to put pressure in the beginning, not late on. And that's the thing with Pascal. He fights in spots and then he likes to rest. Hopkins is going to be on him. He's going to be in great shape. And he's going to have to be youthful. I mean, he's going to have to be a little physical, maybe. He's going to have to rough Hopkins up a little bit. Remind Hopkins that he is a younger and stronger man.
All right, let's take a look at the tail of the tape now for Hopkins against Jean Pascal. And of course, the first statistic is the glaring one, an 18-year age advantage for Pascal. 2-inch height advantage for Hopkins. Pascal with a half-inch arm length advantage measured from the armpit to the end of the fist. Pascal weighed in under the 175-pound limit. Bernard Hopkins needed 3 trips to the scale to ultimately make weight. Tonight, they will both enter the ring at 186. Let's take a look at CompuBox numbers from their first fight again back in December. And here's the reason why so many ringsiders felt that Hopkins had won. Despite the 2 early knockdowns for Pascal, Hopkins nearly doubled Pascal in total number of punches landed, threw 150 more punches than Pascal, landed at a significantly higher rate, and down the stretch seemed to be in control of the fight. The 11th and 12th rounds were Bernard's 2 most active rounds in the fight. CompuBox power punch numbers, again, he significantly outlanded Pascal, almost doubling Pascal's number of landed power punches. He threw 109 more. What more do you have to do, he would say, to win the fight? But again, he was knocked down twice. Pascal took the first 4 rounds. At that moment, Bernard was behind by 6 points on the scorecard. A little bit earlier, our Max Kellerman conducted a face-off with Bernard Hopkins and Jean Pascal getting ready for this fight. Max, I understand there were fireworks.
Hopkins, a master of psychological warfare, must have thought the face-off format was made for him.
I got knocked down. Anybody can be knocked down. Anybody can be knocked out. But it's not what happened, it's what happens next. And what happened next is you bitched. You ran, you didn't fight.
I forced the fight, and from the fifth round to the 12th round, I was in your ass, and you was ready to quit, and you was blowing and puffing, and went to your corner like a rag doll, done, defeated, and knew that you lost that fight. Yeah. That's how gangster I am. All right. I guarantee you, you won't be able to do it because you don't have it in you.
Listen.
You don't got, you're a four-round fighter. Promise Max and promise the world.
You won't leave Canada with those belts.
Promise the world that you will fight every round hard like you fight the first two or three rounds.
Well, listen. You said,
all right, give me a breakdown. I'm going to listen to you. Go ahead. Okay.
Max, see, you said he has such a great defense. He doesn't have such a great defense. The only reason why he has a good defense is because he's scared. He don't get punched. He's scared. And listen, this is Bernard's defense.
And you couldn't knock me out from that?
Come on, Bernard, man. Be real with you. Be real. Stop lying to the fans. Be real. Be a soldier, man. Stand up and act like a real man, like a real fighter.
Hopkins was dominant, but he was working in his first language, English. Pascal was working with his third. Creole is first, French is second, English is third. You all came here to yell and cheer on this occasion. Bernard, at 46, has many wins and so few losses. With all his might, no draw tonight. He'll do it. He'll do it his way. Bernard, it's up to you. You know what to do to win this rematch. You punch to the left, shot to his nose, and down he goes. You're on to victory. It's a fact. He's not coming back. He's down for the count. And the ref counts him out now. It's a TKO. It's Bernard's show. He'll do it. He'll do it his way. Yes, there were times. Jean Pascal, who left his native Haiti at age 4, moved here to Montreal and has never left. At the initial news conference to promote this fight, Pascal felt that he drew blood with a casual comment that suggested that perhaps Hopkins was using performance enhancement drugs. Watch the reaction.
Asking, are you willing to take the test? The damn test? Are you willing to take the test? Are you willing to take the test? Are you willing to take the test for the benefit of the fans? Are you willing to take the fast? Are you willing to take the test for the fans? For the fans! You're a fucking cheater! You're a fucking cheater, man! You're a cheater!
Was Hopkins legitimately angry at the accusation? Or was he simply leaping at a chance to confront the younger fighter?
It's over. Quand moi je vais embarquer sur le ring, je vais pas voir une légende. Je vais voir un morceau de viande parce que je vais être affamé comme un chien pour remporter la victoire.
Kind of soft, that kind of silly.
feel like royalty right now. Everybody up out of your seat. What you can't see. The champ is here. Let's go. See, you the type. You read about history. You the type. You make your history. Let's go.
Fuck you. Fuck our phone. Fuck the fire.
Let's go to Michael Buffer for the official introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir et bienvenue à l'événement principal, 12 rounds pour le championnat du monde. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBC, IBO, and Ring Magazine Light Heavyweight Championship of the World. Presenté par le groupe Yvan Michel et Golden Boy Promotions, sponsorisé par Dynasty 2. Une co-présentation de mise au jeu de Vidéotron en collaboration avec Coors Light. Sanctionné par des sports de combat, de l'allergie, des accords, des courses à des jours. Directeur Michel Hamlin. WBC Supervisors at Ringside, Executive Director Mauricio Suleiman and Joe Dwyer. IBO Supervisor Wilton Hilton Whitaker III. And at Ringside, the three judges, les trois juges sont Guido Cavalieri from Italy, from the Philippines, Renate Danseco, and from Thailand, Anek Hong Tong Khan. And inside the ring, in charge of the action at the bell, from England, the referee, l'arbitre, Ian John Lewis. And now, ladies and gentlemen, for the largest boxing crowd in the history of the Bell Center, 17,560. Mesdames et messieurs, et vous prêts? Mesdames et messieurs, de le Centre Bell, Montréal, Québec, Canada. Let's get ready to rumble! Oquan Blue, the blue corner, wearing blue. Official weight, 174, 14 ounces. His career, 59 fights, 51 victories, including 32 knockouts with 5 defeats and 1 draw. He's a future Hall of Famer from the city of brotherly love, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, USA. The former undisputed middleweight world champion, and former light heavyweight champion of the world, Bernard the Executioner Hopkins. Croix Rouge in the red corner, wearing black, officially weighing 174, 14 ounces, 28 fights, 28 victories, including 16 knockouts with only one defeat and one draw. And in his career as a light heavyweight, he is undefeated. Originally from IET, now living, training, and fighting out of Montreal, Quebec, Canada, presenting the reigning, defending WBC and Ring Magazine IBO light heavyweight champion of the world, champion du monde,
Bernard Hopkins beat this strong, hungry, young champion in the champion's hometown to break George Foreman's record as the oldest man to win a championship in the history of boxing.
Box. The Bell Center is packed to the rafters. The crowd is in rapture as the clock takes us close to midnight and May 22. And these two men get into the ring to fight for the light heavyweight championship of the world. The pace of the first fight was slow, marked by occasional explosions. That's the basic nature of a Bernard Hopkins fight. Emmanuel Stewart, he is brilliant at slowing the pace and limiting opponents' offense. How do you expect this to go, Emmanuel?
Well, I tell you right now, what Bernard is making him do is making him burn up a lot of energy by moving around a lot. And I think Pascal is going to have to be a little bit more physical. He's got to be a little bit more aggressive. Because if he doesn't, Bernard would drain him. But what's unusual, Bernard has said he's going to come out early in this fight applying pressure. And traditionally, a Bernard Hopkins fight, after four rounds, he very seldom is ahead on points. He's usually behind because he waits until it's comfortable to pick up the pace. He cannot do that in this fight.
Once again, in their first fight in December, Pascal won the first four rounds, knocked Hopkins down twice, built a six-point margin on the scorecards, was able to make it hold up, seemingly with the help of sympathetic judges, to get the draw and hold on to his championship. Hopkins has promised he'll start earlier tonight. He derisively refers to Pascal as a four-round fighter.
Well, that's because Pascal, most of his fights, he tires to the end. He's a very hyper-emotional guy, as we saw just before the fight started. And that way burns up a lot of his energy just off of those emotions.
Hopkins, so good at moving away from punches,
as they travel their trajectory. So good at taking the power off of punches by turning his head or rolling his shoulder. So good at every small defensive nuance the sport offers.
Well, Bernard is from the old school, and he's from the Philadelphia, those type places where they learned to box the old school way, and that's what Pascal is just the opposite, seems very green, and it's a big question of whether Pascal can have picked up that polish or seasoning in this short period of time, because he still fights like a hyper, for the most part, amateur-type fighter.
Hopkins fighting with his lead glove, almost like they used to hold it 100 years ago, Emmanuel, almost old, with his palm facing his chin.
That's the old style, which I believe in. Instead of holding the right hand more on the side of the head, he keeps it right near the center.
All right hand by Pascal, and the body shot. First two significant landed punches of the fight. And in that late rally toward the end of the round, you saw how Pascal burns energy. He has to explode.
Yes, and what he did at the end of the round is what he should be doing more often.
All right, that's just bullshit. He's trying to steal.
Very useful with Bernard.
Cut the ring down. Don't follow this motherfucker. Cut the ring down. The jab gonna find his range, actually. When you start doubling up that jab, you're gonna start seeing that right hook open up to the body. This joker just trying to steal rounds now. He's gonna just jump around. So cut the ring off. Let him see you come to fight.
Okay? Bon premier round.
Good first round. Good first round, chap.
Surtout quand on se retrouve medium distance et là on
explose. Make sure you're at a medium distance and then be explosive.
Nice, relax.
Get the center of the ring. The center of the ring belongs to you.
Okay, il est obligé de travailler. Il est
he's going to have
là.
To work. He's not. You're at home. He's not. He's going to have to work. Make him work in there.
Good job.
Well, this fight got off to the typical Bernard Hopkins start. He landed two punches in the first round, only threw 11. Pascal was 4 of 35. We did not get a chance to interview Chad Dawson at the end of the first fight. His unanimous decision win over Adrian Jacquinou. But Chad joins us now at ringside in round two, along with his new trainer, Emmanuel Stewart. Chad, congratulations on the win.
Thank you, thank you.
How'd you like your performance?
Could be a little better, you know, ring rust. You know, I try to execute everything, man, so and it's put together, but, you know, it takes time, you know. We have to be together a lot longer, you know. The next fight, I definitely will be ready for the winner of this fight.
Chad, we have a question from the audience. A fan wants to know, did you hurt your right hand? You didn't throw it much later in the fight.
No, I didn't hurt my right hand. You know, Adrian was a slick fighter. You know, he threw a lot of looping shots. You know, he was strong, you know. I just try to control the pace of the fight, you know, and just dictate what was going on.
What do you see here, Chad?
I see the first round, you know, a lot of filling out. You know, like this round, they're both taking a little bit of some more chances, you know, so, Bernard's looking pretty good, you know, he's not making too many mistakes, you know, he's trying to be cautious. Same as Pascal, you know, both of them are very cautious. Look like they're just filling each other out. I don't know how much longer this is going to last, but looking to be so far as a slow pace, just like the first fight.
Do you have any preference as to whether ultimately this becomes a rematch with Pascal or the fight you've wanted for so long against Bernard Hopkins?
It really doesn't matter. You know, I would love to get the revenge on Pascal, and I would love to get in the ring with Bernard Hopkins, who's a legend, you know, just to get that name on my resume.
Who would you prefer, Emmanuel?
I really wouldn't matter either one, you know, because Pascal, a rematch him would be great, but naturally, Bernard Hopkins is one of the greatest middleweights ever, and it would be an honor to fight him, but either way would be good, and in fact, it seems like the fight most likely is going to end up possibly if everyone is made back here in Montreal. This seems to be the hottest spot in boxing right now.
This crowd would indicate that it is.
Minute to go in round two. Pascal has had a couple of those swarming attacks at Hopkins early in the first minute of this round. Hopkins countered, fought back. Generally speaking, Bernard has not attempted in any way to attack John Pascal. He's waiting for Pascal to come to him.
Emmanuel, Chad, quickly, your first fight together. How do you think it went?
Well, I thought it was good, you know. And the Acadu fought one of his best fights, which we expected. With his hometown support, the Romanian crowd, the Lucien Boutte crowd here cheering him on, he fought beyond his normal level. So he fought very hard tonight. I thought Chad fought well. He could do better, but it takes time.
Chad, how about you, your first fight with Emmanuel Stewart?
Like Emmanuel said, it takes time. You know, we've been together for 6 or 7 weeks. So, you know, it takes time, you know. I definitely like his training methods, you know. I'm looking forward to next training camp.
All right, Chad, thank you very much for spending time with us. Congratulations on your 30th win. Looking forward to seeing you again soon.
Thank you.
There were two significant landed punches in that round that I saw. One was a Pascal left hook. The other was a Pascal body shot. By my lights, he's probably won the first two rounds.
Desperate, man. Very tough to score, though. He looks much stronger, much more powerful than Bernard does. But Bernard seems to be very determined.
Stay off the straight line, because all he's doing is ducking his head and running forward. Stay off that straight line, Ed. When you take that angle, step over left, step over right. Stay behind that stick, put them short shots underneath. Don't go big with him.
He doesn't know how to go at it. Get at you. Get near him very slow, then explode. Give your best shots, but keep a good, safe defense. Get at him slowly and then surprise this guy. All right, you got to master the center of the ring. That center of the ring belongs to you. He's moving around. He doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know what to do. So keep going. Official attendance at the Bell Center tonight, 17,750. You'd be hard-pressed to get another body into the building. Punches in round two, Pascal 6 of 24, Hopkins 4 of 27. So far, they've landed fewer than 20 punches in the fight.
Tough for Hopkins.
Harold Letterman agrees with me that Pascal won the first two.
Tough for Hopkins to come to Montreal and win a decision. He doesn't knock anyone out anymore, it doesn't seem. Against a guy who got an unpopular draw against him last time, and in the first two rounds, he may have lost each by two punches in each round. Not a formula for success.
Indeed, Hopkins hasn't had a knockout in 10 fights since Oscar De La Hoya in 2004. So when George Foreman says Bernard has to seal the deal with a knockout this time, he's asking for something outside the norm.
And that's true, particularly with a young, strong fighter like Pascal is.
Never been off his feet. Finished every fight.
In the first fight, we saw how slippery the ring is, and Hopkins almost slipped there. And Pascal catches him inside with the left. Hopkins got a couple of body shots in.
This is the type of a fight that Pascal should fight and not be moving away so much. He's much younger, much faster, and stronger, and he needs to fight that type of a fight. Moving forward, rough explosion-type punches and not backing away so much.
Pascal's promoter and trainers say that he was awed by Hopkins' reputation in the first fight, and that's why he wasn't more aggressive.
These are some real hard shots Hopkins is landing here.
That's the first offensive explosion of the fight for Hopkins.
And maybe we spoke too soon about his lack of knockouts recently.
That Hopkins goes in with his head first, clearly intentionally.
I think Hopkins actually hurt Pascal then with that right hand.
Wanted to rub him in the face with his head just for good measure.
Now Bernard jabbing and coming forward. You know that Bernard Hopkins feels he has an advantage when he begins to jab and come forward.
Pascal has been hurt because I'm looking at his legs, particularly when he was in the clinches there.
What do you see, Emmanuel?
He's a younger fighter, but his legs look much weaker in the clinches. I think he was hurt with that right hand.
You see his knees buckling?
Yes, even in the clinches, you know, his legs look very unsteady.
Jean Pascal, by his account, has never been knocked down, professional or amateur. We know that as a pro, he hasn't been down.
Hopkins looks like he's trying to put him down here.
Pascal had the traditional amateur career. They both landed shots there. Bernard's right hand, probably the harder of the two. Pascal had the traditional amateur career. Hopkins' amateur career took place in Greaterford Prison, where he spent 4.5 years from the time as a teenager when he was involved in an armed robbery until he was released from prison and the warden said, I'll see you when you come back. He hasn't made another mistake.
Bernard is fighting, but not his normal fight tonight. He's very aggressive and punching with a lot of power early in the fight.
Good body shot by Pascal. And Pascal finishes the round with an offensive rally. June 11th, tune into the next HBO Sports documentary, McEnroe, Borg, Fire and Ice. It's a look back at the hyper-intense John McEnroe and the ultra-low-key Bjorn Borg and how these men came to admire and respect each other along the way, just like boxers. July 2, it's finally here. The long-awaited matchup between heavyweight champ Vladimir Klitschko and his verbal nemesis, David Haye. They meet in the ring live on HBO with a replay later that evening.
Hey, gotta keep your hand up. Keep your right hand way high. You gotta explode when you get to him. But you got caught. Keep your right hand way up high.
You ever see Bernard land the right hand, which I thought was the best punch of the fight. And to me, I think may have changed the course of the fight, because from that point on, seemed like Bernard had more confidence. And I saw a look in Pascal's eyes where he's beginning to worry and doubt himself now.
After landing so few punches in the first couple rounds, Hopkins was 12 of 34 in what amounts to a big offensive round for him in round three. Pascal was 7 of 31, but the big right hand was probably the decisive blow in the round. Harold, how do you have it through three?
Okay, Jim, 29-28, two rounds to one, Jean Pascal. You know, Jim, Pascal gets off, he starts very, very quick in every fight that he's in. But in round three, Bernard Hopkins went to work. He landed beautiful left hooks. He landed that nice right hand, and Jean Pascal started to cover up. When Bernard gets offensive, when Bernard goes to work, Pascal doesn't punch back. He covers up. Two rounds to one, Pascal.
Pascal at this point right here looks insecure, unsteady, and not as confident as he was earlier.
Why is Bernard finding success with long looping right hands from outside, Emmanuel?
Well, he's throwing them. He's always had the punches, but he normally would never fight until the last half of his fights. He's that type of a safety type fighter, but I think he's very, really angry, and the nasty side of him is coming out tonight in this fight with Pascal.
Hopkins reaching and landing a jab. Gets in a right cross as well.
Oh, this is a fun side of Bernard Hopkins to watch.
Lead right hand landed for Hopkins. Hopkins saying to us yesterday, at age 46, in his 60th pro fight, that he's planning to be more entertaining. The entertaining part is that you're more vulnerable, Bernard. Back in the day, he dominated fights during his 20-fight run as middleweight champion of the world. Good body shot by Hopkins, good body shot by Pascal. Hard right hand by Pascal. Now Pascal begins to assert himself again, but his faster hands show.
He needs to do this more often because he's much faster, much stronger, and much more sturdier, but the problem is he fights in spots. And now when he's going on vacation, Bernard is going to gradually start taking control of the fight again.
But because Pascal punches like he means it, unlike Jermaine Taylor at times, and unlike Calzaghe usually, he's forcing Bernard, I think, to be more exciting, Emmanuel, to dig harder and throw harder shots.
Absolutely. That plus the bad blood between the two of them, making Bernard fight out of his normal style.
This rematch was ordered on Pascal by the governing body because of what the governing body saw as questionable scoring in the first fight. Golden Boy protested vigorously, Hopkins' promoter, about the judges in the first fight, and partially in response to that.
Oh,
there are no Canadian
Hopkins
judges here.
Hurt.
Big right hand by Pascal. Hopkins backs up. And now Bernard seems to recover pretty quickly from the shot. But that brought the crowd out of their seats.
Tremendous punch. I mean, he was seriously hurt. I think that's the first time in his career that I saw Bernard hurt.
Agreed. Like that, yes.
Slug with him in there. Grab his ass. Don't try to trade with him in that young shit. Grab his ass when he starts there putting his head down wild shit. Just tie him up. Make him box you out there. He can't box. He gonna duck his head and go to a slug match.
Here you see the right hand that comes by Pascal, one of those right hands that Bernard got hit with that normally he would not have gotten hit with early in the fight because he plays it safe. But this time he's exchanging, as you said, Jim, he's making it much more exciting, but also much more easier to get hit and hurt than he does in his previous fights.
And that's the point. In order to be more exciting, you have to be more vulnerable. Bernard's not accustomed to that. Excitement comes from taking risks. Great fighters are comfortable taking risks in most instances, but Hopkins, by and large, has always been a risk-limiting fighter.
Thank you.
Hopkins has admitted that Pascal is a tremendous puncher. He calls him a clubber, who throws with the kind of force that moves you when it lands. And only Hopkins' heart and conditioning, I think, kept him up in that round.
But after the big finish to round three, or round four, I should say, Pascal comes out tentatively in round five before landing that little body shot. Good hard left hook and an uppercut. And once again, Pascal got the Hopkins chin.
Yeah, Pascal is just waiting and fighting in the spurts. But so far, it's worked out pretty fair for him. And based on this fight being in Montreal, probably is ahead on the scorecards.
Well, what happens is he gets into that lull. Things are slow, and then he erupts, and the hand speed can be shocking.
Hopkins got a warning for using his head earlier. That's the second time he's done that after he's been stunned or something.
And just to finish the point I was making earlier, after everything that happened in December, that's an English referee, and the judges are from Italy, Philippines, and Thailand. Nobody from Canada, nobody from the United States.
But even with that, they're often influenced by the crowd. Being realistic, I mean, even though they may be from neutral places, they're influenced often by the crowd's reaction.
Hopkins landed a little right hand. Pascal attacked him with a left hook and a body shot at the ropes.
Heard Hopkins' trainer, Nazim Richardson, in the corner say, don't get involved with that young stuff.
Don't trade with it.
Basically, go back to fighting your old style.
Right, as an old man, he's fighting a young man's fight here.
He is.
And he's fighting it
right
well.
On the belt line. The Hopkins body shot. And now he's holding Pascal with the left while hitting with the right.
Don't put him down. You okay? Good. Box on.
Part of the first fight. Hopkins landing slightly larger number of punches, Pascal landing the harder, more significant punches. Higher, higher, keep your hands higher. I know you're trying to put your left shoulder before you. He's seen it. That's why he's using his jab on him. Come near him. Take his jab away from him. Keep his right hand away from him.
Duck. Drop that uppercut. Wipe his nose with that damn hook. Teach this young boy some lessons. You in your rhythm now. Just keep them hands up for me. All right, you see when you tied him up. You see, as soon as you started that wild stuff, and you tied him up, it calms him down. Don't get into those little wild shit with him, man.
Okay, turn him in. Come on.
Angle off. Don't go straight back.
CompuBox numbers in the fifth round found Pascal landing only 4 of 27 punches, Hopkins 8 out of 31. And Pascal landed the harder punches. Hopkins has an overall land advantage. And he starts out the sixth round with a pop. But as you can see, Harold Lederman has scored 4 of the first 5 rounds for Pascal.
Archie Moore was in his 40s. He fought Canadian Yvon Durrell in one of the all-time great fights in boxing history, and Moore won. This is not exactly that so far, but especially for a Bernard Hopkins fight, this is a lot of action here tonight.
Yeah, I'm very impressed with Bernard's performance at this point in the fight. Regardless of what the score is, he fought a very good, aggressive fight.
Yvon Durrell knocked Archie Moore down 3 times early. Moore knocked Durrell down 4 times to reel him in and win the fight.
No knockdowns here, but both guys have been legitimately hurt.
In the corner between rounds, and via our French translator, Chris Jose, you heard Pascal's trainer telling him, keep your hands up, fight more carefully, don't fall for his tricks. Hard right hand by Hopkins.
Come on.
Another hard right hand by Hopkins. Straight right hand lead landed that time. Hopkins mixing it up a little. Another right hand lead for Hopkins.
And Hopkins now using it a little more intelligently from a greater distance, tying Pascal up after he lands it.
I think he's way ahead of Pascal in this round with a tactical adjustment, which has made it hard for Pascal to see the punches coming.
When I say don't hold,
I'm very, very impressed with
Bernard. Right, do you understand me? Prepare ya, okay? Box!
That British referee, Ian John Lewis, is the referee who allowed Vitali Klitschko to beat Shannon Briggs into the hospital.
But I thought he took charge there in a good way.
Well, you saw Pascal blink in his eye. Something happened when Bernard hit him in his eye. But at this point, Bernard is totally taking control of the fight.
And now Hopkins is arguing with the referee as he holds on to Pascal while the referee, Ian John Lewis, tries to get him to break.
Third warning now for using his head, Hopkins.
It only stands to reason that a British referee who has never dealt with this boxing legend might be more reluctant to penalize him than would an American referee who's known him for years.
And this is one of the roughest fights that I've saw a referee have to work in a long time, too. Both of them style is, you know, where Bernard has always been accused of doing a lot of rough tactics, and Pascal right now is a run-in, punch, grab type fighter.
Another right-hand lead.
Bernard is winning this round big.
Yep, he certainly is. He's made a tactical adjustment that Pascal wasn't able to follow. And now they're talking to each other. And Pascal is losing his composure. And you cannot allow Bernard Hopkins to goal you into that. Look at me. Look at me. Breathe carefully. Breathe, breathe deeply. You got to lift your right hand way up higher. Every time he's getting at you, keep your hands up high. Explode. You got to be the aggressor. He's getting at you.
Between the glove. He's going to show it to you. Tip your hat. Straight right hand. Wipe his nose with that hook. All right? You're a legend. He's ducking his head throwing wild stuff.
Yeah, we see Bernard right here. Duck under the punch and did a couple of whacks. Maybe you call it illegal, but I don't think they did any damage to the kidneys of Pascal. And now you see right here, you see a jab which went right inside, and the left thumb of Hopkins went right into the eye of Pascal.
Okay, so we saw kidney punches and a thumb to the eye. And maybe the kidney punches didn't do damage, but Emmanuel, they're still illegal, aren't they? Now Hopkins is doing push-ups in the ring to try to embarrass his younger opponent.
Everything, it looks to me, has been done intentionally. The thumb, the head, the kidney shots, obviously. Hopkins is pulling out every trick in the book.
Now, answer my question. The kidney shots are still illegal,
the kidney
right?
shots is illegal, but it wasn't that major. But I think the things that he's doing now, the thumb, I think, did a lot of damage to his eye. But he's taking total control over the fight at this point.
Harold, how do you have it through six?
Okay, Jim, 4 rounds to 2, 58-56, Sean Pascal. Jim, I believe that at round six, Bernard Hopkins got into his rhythm. Not before that. He started to get off first, and that was the key to him winning the first fight. When he gets off first, he freezes Pascal just like he did right there. He lands good shots, and he dominates Pascal. He's got to throw that first punch. Bernard Hopkins coming forward, landed the good shots, but still 4-2, Pascal.
Harold, did you hear what you said? You said that was the key to Hopkins winning the first fight.
He got off first all night, Jim.
It was a draw.
Oh, well, oh. You know what happened. He shows up! Boy, hurry up! Get your head up!
Why does a fighter have to pick his head up? Hopkins wasn't hitting him behind the head.
This is a very entertaining fight for the crowd.
Hee-hop chant here in Montreal.
But is Hee-hop resting this round?
Yes, but he did enough, I thought, in the beginning of the round to win this round, because Pascal has not did anything while Bernard has taken a break the last minute.
And the ref may have done Pascal a favor when he told him not to bend over, because Hopkins was whacking him pretty good with both hands during that time.
Right hand lead lands again for Hopkins. He's relying more and more on the right hand lead, less and less on the jab. He's not using that brilliant right hand counterpunch of his, which has been his primary offensive weapon much of the time.
He's, to me, that's all of a round fight, a fantastic fight.
Good left hook.
Every round has been tremendous.
Another wrestling match. We've had a couple of those. Hopkins outlanding Pascal significantly through this portion of the fight. Good left hook by Bernard. That was a slip. Two different fights. In the Dawson-Diakonu fight, it was so clean, I never used the referee Mark Griffin's name. This is different.
Totally different.
That
guy has to go back. You've got to move him back. You need to attack this guy. Straightforward attacks. Work inside. Keep under, but work inside. Work your way in.
Close the distance with that right hand now. Drop it right on the collarbone for me, straight. Come back with the hook. Behind your jab, you're a different athlete. Keep corralling. He started his antics when he started getting tired. He started his antics. Start them good body shots going again. Time to finish him out. Start the body shot.
Copy box numbers in the seventh round. Pascal, 6 out of 30. Hopkins, 16 out of 37. 16 connected punches, the high number in the fight so far for Bernard. On Harold Lederman's card, Pascal won 4 of the first 5 rounds, but in the 6th and the 7th, Bernard Hopkins has struck back.
Maybe it's because of the crowd. Maybe because Hopkins is trying to make history. Maybe it's because they're both throwing real hard shots, but there's a kind of nervous energy in this building tonight that you don't always find, even in big prize fights nowadays.
You know what, I know this sounds awkward, but strange, but I think Bernard is fighting the best fight I've ever saw him fight, aside from the Trinidad fight. When you consider his age, and you consider this crowd and everything, and as young as this man is, I've never saw him fight this aggressive early in a fight.
Emmanuel, do you remember how completely he dominated Antonio Tarver and Kelly Pavlik in Atlantic City?
Yeah, but I would think this is better. It was a different. He's fighting much more aggressive, power punches. He won those fights, made those guys look bad, but not with the aggression and determination that he's fighting with tonight.
Oh, so I hear what you're saying. You're an offensive trainer who appreciates offensive fighters, and you want to see Bernard take more risks
and
he's try to fight
tonight.
Offensive.
Yes.
Yeah, you know, against Tarver and Pavlik.
Oh! Super right hand by Hopkins. More wrestling. Finish the point, Max.
Against Tarver and Pavlik, Hopkins fought a very controlled fight and completely dominated both, outboxing them. As his physical tools have eroded somewhat, his skills are still there, but his reflexes. He is 46 years old now, after all. And he's fighting a big, strong, in his prime, light heavyweight champ.
Another sensational right hand.
He's been forced to go away from the smoke and mirrors, Bernard Hopkins, and become more of a real fighter, a more of a blood and guts guy.
Emmanuel, Pascal seems to be easier and easier to hit, particularly with those right hand leads. Why is he open to the right hand lead?
And the left jabs are still working a lot. He's still hitting those jabs inside, meaning Bernard. I think it's just the experience and the seasoning that Bernard has that Pascal still hasn't developed.
Pascal's punches did not land solidly there, though the crowd got excited.
Yeah, but Bernard's jabs are working.
Another big right hand for Hopkins. He is landing some sensational right crosses in this round.
Totally different from Bernard in the past.
If you live long enough, you see Shane Mosley stink it out and Hopkins light it on fire.
There's a look at what has happened in the fight so far. Pascal landed more punches in the first two rounds. Hopkins landed more punches in each of the next six. This repeats a pattern in the first fight. Hopkins landed more punches in 11 of 12 rounds in the first fight. So there simply are seldom, if ever, any rounds where Pascal is able to dominate Hopkins offensively, because Bernard is so gifted at limiting Pascal's offense.
When he lowers his head, get to him, John. As soon as he's got his head down, you got to get to him.
You're doing good, champ. Keep going. Here you see Bernard land a tremendous right hand, and what was so special about this is the fact that he landed about three or four of those. And Pascal could not land a clean, effective punch the entire round.
An entirely different Bernard Hopkins in deep. Scoring with right hand leads, not waiting for the chance to counter with the right hand, attacking with it.
But he's going in and getting in exchanges.
We're in the ninth of schedule 12, and incidentally, fight is now even on Harold Letterman's scorecard. Four rounds apiece. That was a good punch for Pascal, but Hopkins was moving away, taking the impact off of it.
Hopkins has been very good.
That is a knockdown. That should have been called a knockdown. He landed a punch and the glove touched the canvas. I believe that was a knockdown.
That was definitely a knockdown.
And if it was, it would have been the first knockdown of Pascal's career.
His foot was slipping on the wet mat.
He would not have went down without being touched by
a punch. You guys,
even if it was on the shoulder.
Pretty close call. Another big right hand for Hopkins. Pascal countering this time.
I'm glad it wasn't called a knockdown.
Better for the fight.
I think it was more accurately reflects what really happened.
Probably right, but we'll see if the glove touched the canvas, I hope.
The rounds that Pascal has won, with the exception of the round where he hurt Hopkins badly, have not been by as obvious margins as the rounds that Hopkins has won, I think.
Hopkins just landed a great left hook. He's landing clean punches throughout the whole fight. And what has impressed me, he's willing to stand toe-to-toe and still goes underneath and slips and slides, and Pascal can't hit him even when they have the exchanges.
In terms of pure boxing craft, Bernard Hopkins outclasses Jean Pascal, and Pascal is the champion of the world. That's no embarrassment. Bernard Hopkins is the absolute master of craft among current boxers. What is another wrestling match?
What is Pascal wincing about on the inside there? He's really wincing like he's in pain.
I don't know if he's fully recuperated from where that thumb from Bernard's left jab went in his right eye.
And he's blinking with the left eye, too, frankly. Now Pascal showed that he listened to his trainers. They said when Hopkins bends his head over, you have to hit it.
Yeah, Hopkins may want to keep his hands up.
Come on, little kids! Fight! Let go! Fight out, let go!
Well, if nothing else, Pascal seems to have managed to slow Hopkins' offense just a little bit in this round. Bernard isn't exactly painting him with right hands, and he paints him with the right hand.
He's so easy to get hit with those right hand leads.
Okay, box shot.
Even it's been a good round at the end. Oh. Still, Pascal cannot land the clean punches.
Hopkins got a left hand body shot and then a left hook upstairs in the corner.
I'm gonna beat this guy with a jab.
Yeah, but you gotta swim without getting wet, son. Stay off them ropes and run the combinations on him. He's trying to steal. He always fading the late round, so he saves everything to try to go home now in the late round. Don't let him steal, John. We still in Canada. Don't let him steal.
tes jambes. Il faut que tu travailles, man.
Use your legs. You got to work in there.
On s'approche les mains hautes, on explose. Il faut
get
que tu le fasses.
Him. Get to him and explode with your hands up high. Go upstairs.
Here you see Hopkins land a right hand that hit on the side of the head of Pascal. Pascal went down as a result of that, though, even though it was not a power punch, the referee didn't call it a knockdown. Officially, it really is. If you touch your gloves,
you're both right.
Any punch that hit you,
you're both right. I was wrong. It's a knockdown.
Yeah, but I was glad they didn't call it. I'm glad they didn't call it a knockdown, but officially it was.
Punches in the ninth round. Pascal 6 of 26, Hopkins 12 of 31. In all likelihood, Bernard has moved ahead on an objective scorecard.
Harold,
Letterman, that should have been scored a knockdown.
Jim, I don't know. I mean, you know, it was a clean knockdown. There's no doubt about it. Bernard Hopkins hit him. Jean Pascal's gloves touched. That's a knockdown. Ian John Lewis blew in, period. End of story. It was a knockdown.
But you cannot score the round 10-8.
Why not? Why not?
Did you?
He won the round. No. He won the round and he knocked it down. No, he didn't call it a knockdown. So it's going to 10-9.
Because they didn't call it a knockdown, you can't score it 10-8, right?
Well, you could score it 10-8 if you, I mean, if you feel that Pascal was badly hurt, but you obviously don't feel that way, Harold.
No, I don't. I mean, you know, it's a close round, but Bernard won it. Be as it may, Bernard Hopkins goes into the lead. He wins four rounds in a row easily with the lead right hand. Five rounds to four, 86-85, Bernard Hopkins.
He's
good left hook.
He's actually out boxing.
Uppercut by Pascal
with his jab. His jab has been consistent. He's landing the right hand. He's landing the lunge and left hooks. All the way around. He's roughing him up.
He's becoming increasingly dominant as the rounds go by. Which was the case in the first fight as well. Now, one judge gave Pascal a 10-10 round, an even round in the 12th of the first fight. That was instrumental in helping to create the draw. Pascal lands a right hand.
That's another one.
And again, his glove touches the canvas. And again, it's going to be ruled not a knockdown. I'm not as sure that that was an official knockdown, but the first one surely was.
Well, regardless of whether it's a knockdown or not, all of those right-handed leads that he's hitting him with, you know, it doesn't do him any good.
You know, I'll tell you what, guys. Twice his coincidence, three times his pattern. He keeps slipping like that after Hopkins clocks him in the face. Maybe they were both knocked out.
Between fights, Coca-Cola was poured on that big painted area in the center of the ring to try to make it more tacky.
Bernard has beaten him in every area right now. Outside of that one big right hand he got caught with, he's beaten Pascal all the way.
Pascal just landed a left hook. But again, Hopkins was moving away.
But Hopkins landed a solid jab when he was coming in also.
Well, down in Houston, Texas, George Foreman is watching. And surely, the great champion will be rooting for B-Hop in the next two rounds. Take a deep breath.
All right, let's organize our defense. Let him give you his first two shots, but react. As soon as he's at a safe distance, you become the attacker. Get near him, be at ease, but be the aggressor.
You ain't got to leave your feet. Bring your feet with you. You ain't got to lunge. Tip your hat, right hand, left hook.
Here we once again see Bernard land a right hand lead through the center, got out of the way, and as a result of landing the punch, Pascal went down again. He touched the gloves, touched the floor. Should have been another knockdown. He would not have went down and touched the floor if he hadn't have been hit.
It was really the momentum of his own miss that carried him down after the hit that is a knockdown.
Once again in the 10th round, Hopkins more than doubled Pascal's landed punch numbers. Pascal hasn't landed double digits in a single round. Hopkins landed 16 punches in that last round. He's now 2 points ahead on Harold Letterman's scorecard, closing in on possibly supplanting George Foreman as the oldest man ever to win a legitimate championship. Foreman was 45. when he knocked out Michael Moorer on November 5, 1994. Hopkins is 192 days older than George was that night.
Now it's Pascal using his head and trying to turn it into an alley fight.
He seems to have the sense of desperation. He seems to be aware that he's trailing in the fight.
He's tired and he doesn't have the season or experience to fight off of natural instincts.
Nor does he have the craft to set up a knockout against a fighter as skilled as Bernard Hopkins. It would have to be, in some way, a fortunate situation. He doesn't have the craft to be able to scientifically set it up.
But he does have the power and the hand speed, and we've seen it earlier in the fight.
Definitely.
Bernard has smothered his punches. Whenever he punches his Pascal's number, he has to have a little swinging rule. Bernard is smothering his punches by going right to the inside.
They're trading leather. Hopkins doesn't exactly love to trade, but he's clearly feeling very confident here. And you can see how difficult it is for Pascal to maintain balance. He landed a left-hand shot and fell all the way across the top of the rope.
Bernard is punching and smothering at the same time.
Pascal is getting the crowd back into the fight. 30 seconds left in this round. Hopkins using the whole ring. Trying to keep Pascal at bay. Canadian fighter has landed only 60 punches all night against the most brilliant defender of modern times.
And even though Pascal had those flares, the extra few clean punches to me for the most part have been by Bernard. Bernard smothers Pascal punches by doing just what he's doing.
All right, every time you do what I tell you to do, it pays off for you. Breathe deeply. Breathe deeply.
Keep going.
Every time he clinches, you get back at him. You hit him where you want to hit him, as long as you hit him. It's going to be a hit.
Finish him out. Bend them knees for me now. Stay off the rope. This jab keeps him from backing you up. Keep that jab alert and alive, baby. When he go to punch, punch in the middle.
Okay,
can we keep him off the back of our head?
Can a young, proud champion, a man in his prime, do something dramatic here to save his title? Does Hopkins have another round left in him?
...23 years in professional boxing. Bernard Hopkins' whole career is a tribute to the advantages of being made, not poor. Throughout his career, his opposite number was the great Roy Jones. He was never brought into the sport with the kinds of gifts that Jones enjoyed. He didn't have all that physical talent. We saw that when first they met in 1993. Bernard had to learn every detail. He had to master the craft, and he did it like no one else in his generation. We saw that when he fought Jones again last year and dominated him just as completely as Jones had dominated him in 93. With what's made, not born, you can last a long, long time, particularly if you live a monastic life. If you don't drink, you don't smoke, you eat the right things, you train as clearly and cleanly as you can. Everything about that defines Bernard Hopkins. Pascal has talent. Pascal has physically given
punches. I mean, the crowd went crazy, but he did not land anything.
That was something pretty dramatic Pascal came up with, and Hopkins, as he's done all night, answered right back.
Pascal is stopping.
The old man is trying to stay away.
He's hurt. His legs are not steady.
And Pascal is cooperating with him.
46 years old and getting a break from the younger man who didn't go after him. Didn't go after him when it mattered most. Less than a minute to go. Less than a minute to history for Hopkins.
Said in 1994, Michael Moore and George Foreman, it happened. Get ready to say it again.
Well, when it happened for George Foreman in 94, it happened out of the blue.
Yes.
On a tremendous 1-2 and a knockout shot. Bernard Hopkins made it happen with hard work, with diligent dedication, and with pride.
And yet, there were some close rounds in this fight, including the last one where Hopkins was badly hurt. We are in Montreal. The first fight most people think Hopkins won, it was a draw.
But the judges are not from Canada or the USA. They are from Italy, the Philippines, and Thailand. Which in theory means objectivity. Let's take a look back at some highlights from the fight. Very quickly. Round three. After Pascal had won the first two rounds, Hopkins started to come on. Hit him with that big right hand. But then in round four, Hopkins was hurt. As Pascal had the first chance to possibly press his advantage. Round six, Hopkins, kidney punches, thumbs in the eye, every trick, and then at the beginning of the next round, push-ups to embarrass his opponent. Round nine, was this a knockdown? Two rounds in a row, Pascal's glove touched the canvas after contact from Hopkins' glove. In neither case did Hopkins get credit for a knockdown. Here's the second of those two instances. Swung over the top of Hopkins after a straight right hand, touched the gloves on the canvas. Referee Ian John Lewis of England ruled neither a knockdown. And then in the 12th round, the last big chance for Pascal. That winging right hand, which clearly hurt Hopkins, but with a minute and a half to go in the fight, Pascal was unable to press his advantage, and the old man made it to the finish line, probably to make history. Harold, you scored at 115-113.
Yeah, and to tell you the truth, if he and John Lewis would have at least got one knockdown, he would have won really decisively. I'll tell you something, Jim. Also, he and John Lewis blew an awful lot of those rabbit punches. I mean, Jean Pascal rabbit punched him constantly. He and John Lewis should have taken away a point.
And we have mentioned many times, George Foreman, you'll remember the moment, 1994.
At all time.
It was Joe Cortez refereeing as 26-year-old unbeaten heavyweight champion Michael Moore tried to make a lot of money by defending his title against George Foreman, and he dominated Foreman for the first 9 rounds. But then in the 10th round, things changed, and George stepped up. A first 1-2, then that one, and Moore could not get up. And George Foreman went to the corner to pray in celebration of his great victory. Now Michael Buffer will tell us whether Bernard Hopkins has supplanted Foreman.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, after 12 rounds of boxing, we go to the scorecards. Guido Cavallari scores it 115-113. Danseco Renate, 116-112. Anek Hongtong Kam, 114-115. All to the winner by unanimous decision. And new light heavyweight champion of the world from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The legend lives on, Bernard, the Executioner Hopkins.
To love him, and very few do, but you must respect him. You must respect what he has done. There's a story right in front of you. At a news conference, John Pascal playfully handed his belt to Bernard Hopkins, and Hopkins took it home to Delaware and put it in his living room and didn't give it back. So now, having officially won that belt from Pascal, he hands it back to the vanquished champion.
That's amazing.
Bernard knows how to play the game.
Yeah, but tonight he was spectacular tonight.
Final copy box numbers dominated by Hopkins. He landed nearly twice as many punches. He threw 32 more punches. He landed at a way higher percentage, 32%. He was brilliant, absolutely brilliant with his right hand leads. Jab's not necessarily a big category. Pascal is not good with his jab. Hopkins uses it not necessarily as an offensive setup weapon, more a space finder. Power shots were really where the fight took place. A lot of hubbub in the ring, and there are the power punch numbers. And of Hopkins' 80 landed punches, many of them were sizzling straight right hands, mostly right hand leads, and Pascal never seemed to find a way to try to stop that punch. Emmanuel, you've seen some of the greatest old fighters of all time, going back to Archie Moore and George Foreman. Hopkins, maybe the most unusual of all of them.
Yeah, but you know the fact that he fought from the very beginning. You know, that was what was so amazing. He didn't try to play safe. He just fought.
His conditioning is sensational. And now here he is with Max Kellerman.
Champ, you're now the oldest man in the history of boxing to win a legit championship. How do you feel?
First, I'd like to thank God for the victory and everybody of Germantown and mine area and everybody's locked down there. Great for it. Smokey Wilson played a big role in me doing what I'm doing. I'd like to thank my team. I'd like to thank Golden Boy Promotion. I'd like to thank everybody, Lee Simons, Kelly Swanson, all my team. Max, you put a lot of good work in, and I feel like I'm not 46, but I feel like I'm close to 40, 36. But everything is fine, man. God bless me. I worked hard for this. I had a working team. Golden Boy is the promoters, and I am the OG. I am the OG of Golden Boy.
That's for sure. Of all time now, as it turns out. At 36 is old for a fighter, and you were a great fighter at 36. But you weren't this exciting at 36. What has turned you into this exciting fighter?
Well, I know the fans pay to see fights, and you know, I've been accused of being boring. I was just trying to buy time and buy years for now. I'm gonna finish strong. So I had a plan, even in my boxing career, is to box as well as I can win fights, and then get to the last bit of good orange juice, and then this is what you see. Before I leave this game, y'all gonna see the best fights of Bernard Hopkins' career, and I know that's a big order, providing what I've done already. But I'm vouching and I'm promising that every fight until I retire is going to be breathtaking and it's going to be heartbeating.
So, in the 12 rounds of...
Latrice Hopkins, my daughter, 11, she ain't come because she got a scare of Roy Jones, so I'm going to say hi to Latrice.
So in the 12 rounds of your career, we're here and maybe close to the 12th round, and you've saved yourself for the championship rounds to put it all on the line now?
Yes. But I've always fought with heart, and I always fought with courage to get a guy out of there. But you know, Max, you have to be careful because the guys can punch too, and they study tapes like I study tapes. But you know what? You save the best for last. Like any great entertainer, they normally give a blockbuster performance on the way out of their career. Tina Turner did it. A lot of other entertainers, boxers. So, but I want to go out on a good note. I want to go out on a positive note, and that's being a winner. A winner, not punch drunk, not beat up, and not broke.
He seemed to hurt you badly. I believe it was the third round. How badly were you hurt?
I was hurt when I started training 9 weeks ago. But hey, listen, when you're 46, you know, you get hit with shots that you didn't get hit with early in your career. But I always been known, Max, you know it, since you've been on your ESPN days, even though you graduated to HBO. I could take a good shot when it's needed. I mean, Roy Jones can tell you that. He hit me one of the best left hooks, a young Roy Jones in 93. But, you know, the name of the game is hit, not get hit. And let me tell you something about Gene Pascal. He's tough, he's strong, and if this doesn't discourage him like Kelly Pavlik was, I don't see nobody beating this strong bull from Canada, man. I'm really saying, this ain't victory talk. He has a good, strong punch. He need to work on a couple of things from a legend to a future champion and legend. He need to work on a couple of things. He looked for big shots, and I worked on that. And I know if he successful with the big shots, he's going to be more active. So I had to disappoint him early. But he's a great champion if he takes some of the punch power off every punch. He got to set him up. He got to call steel and set a guy up for the big grand finale.
Do you feel that those were two knockdowns that were not called of him in the middle of the ring?
No, he slipped. It was a punch and a slip, but, you know, could it went either way. You know me, I'm going to tell the referee he got hit. You know, he hit me with a couple of good shots, but I'm in tremendous shape for 46 years old. I run with 21-year-olds, and they give me a run for my money. I beat some, I lose some. But at the end of the day, he fought a great fight. I think the crowd got what they wanted. I think Canada will welcome me back to fight Boutte. I would love to beat Boutte after Chad Dawson, and then I will go on to something bigger and better. I will not retire until I get close to 50. So that's about what, 46? It's about 4 or 5 years from now.
Well, as you say, the ring retires fighters. It hasn't retired you yet. Jean, give us your impression of this fight and what Bernard Hopkins is saying.
First of all, I want to congrats Bernard Hopkins. He fought a great fight. He's a great champion, a great legend, and I did my best. That was a close fight, but I think that we need a part three, and I think the fans want to see a part three.
I believe it was the fourth round where you hurt him. It seemed that you let him off the hook a bit, that you didn't follow your advantage, sort of like in your first fight. Why?
But Bernard has a good defense. He has a lot of tricks, so it's hard to set it up. But I did my best. That was a close fight. He won the fight, but I would like to have a rematch.
Listening to what he says about things you still need to learn, what do you think about that? On just kind of sheer physical ability, he's saying, you were able to give him two really good fights. What do you think about what he says about your skill level?
I know I got skill, but I'm a young fighter. I'm still green. I'm a young champion, and I'm going to come back stronger ever. You know, Bernard gave me a lot of experience. Those two fights going to bring me to the next level.
Thanks a lot, Jean. Congratulations on a great two-fight series with Bernard Hopkins. Jim.
First, let's take a look at a graphic which will show you an assortment of some of the oldest sports champions, the fraternity into which Hopkins has now inserted himself. Jack Nicklaus was 46 when he won the Masters in 1986. Hopkins is about a month older than was Nicklaus at that time. And now turning to Emmanuel Stewart, I love Jean Pascal as a person. He has great spirit. I think he's an exciting fighter. I don't need to see a rematch. I know who's better after watching the first two fights.
No, I definitely don't think that's going to be a rematch, although the public would demand it. But it was an entertaining fight. They broke a record. Very exciting, a lot of emotions involved. But like Bernard says, he wants to move on to history now. He's going to move on to bigger and better things. But in this particular division, whoever he fights next, it seems like it's logical to bring it back to Montreal. This is the spot for the light heavyweight division right now.
Well, and he says who he's going to fight next is your fighter, Chad Dawson. So it looks like what we're headed for is a matchup between your fighter, Chad Dawson, and Bernard Hopkins, and you and another really tremendous trainer in Nassim Richardson. That's a heck of a fight.
It'll be very exciting. I will look forward to it.
All right. We'll look forward to seeing what... you're playing it close to the vest now, I'm sure, because Chad's going to have a big assignment. Thank you very much, Emmanuel, and congratulations on your win with Dawson tonight. Max Kellerman, we saw history.
Jack Nicklaus wasn't even as old as Bernard Hopkins, and Jean-Pascal wasn't throwing haymakers at Jack Nicklaus.
Yep.
It's a much, much greater athletic accomplishment. I can't think of anything quite like it at this age. Not only is Bernard Hopkins this late in his career, and there have been so many codas to his career already, starting with Felix Trinidad, where we thought it might be over. 46 years old, now not only taking more chances in the ring, but being much less selective, it appears, with opponents out of the ring. Chad Dawson, Lucien Boutte, southpaws with speed, who can punch. Fighters it wouldn't seem that anyone would be rushing to get in the ring with, taking more chances in and out of the ring, making exciting fights at an unprecedented age. What can you say about Bernard Hopkins? Amazing.
Absolutely. Well, Bernard Hopkins quite logically walked into the room yesterday. He's a fan of the sport. He's a fan of telecasts. He knows everything anybody's ever said about anybody in boxing. And he asked me for one thing. He said, I'm going to win this fight, and I want to hear two words. So, yes, Bernard, it happened. It happened for you the way it happened for George Foreman in 1994, yes. And it's something that none of us who saw it tonight are likely to forget. It was high drama in Montreal. It was a close, intense prize fight. It was clearly won by a 46-year-old champion who in his career has shown us as much about boxing craft, as much about the small nuances of the sport, as much about an intellectual understanding of how to fight as any fighter we've ever seen. Bernard, congratulations to you. If you've missed any part of tonight's telecast, you can catch it in its entirety at the dates and times listed below. For more boxing updates, check out HBO's Facebook page, HBO Boxing's Twitter feed, and as always, HBO.com. June 4, Boxing After Dark returns with Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., son of the Mexican legend, making his live HBO debut against middleweight title holder Sebastian Spink. And next on HBO, stay tuned for Game of Thrones on the East Coast and Get Him to the Greek on the West Coast. And now for our entire crew, I'm Jim Lampley saying so long from Montreal.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports.